again, boys and girls, from a dark, damp, cool, beautiful basement in a ghostly haunted dwelling. It's been rather quiet here the last week. Your last day of summer in the black swamps of Northwest Ohio. This is Swamp Gas. I am your host, Arizona Tramp, where we're also asking the question, how do fat people clip their toenails? Anyway, it is the last day of summer, but I want to talk to you real quick. I want to talk to you real quick about the Clintons and Trump. It's looking more and more and more like Clinton and Trump. It doesn't matter who gets in office. You know, they're going to be history. Trump will be shot. Clinton's going to die. Clinton was in a plane crash, from what I understand. That's where she received her head injury. She had her medical conditions, and she was in a hospital. She has clones or doubles, whatever you want to call them. One of them has epilepsy. One goes in the building. The other one comes out looking 20 years younger, and everybody seems to buy it. You know, this ties into, okay, we've got these wannabe people going around anymore making these bombs. And they're pressure cooker bombs. I'm not even going to get into it. I think it's crap, okay? And I think it's these cops, they pull over, they shoot, what was it? They shot a guy in a wheelchair. They shot a pastor. It doesn't matter what color they are. They're, one's handicapped, the other is a pastor. He's not going to have a freaking gun. Why'd they shoot him for? They're trying to start something. It looks to me like they're trying to start something so that they can throw martial law in. And what I say? I said something to the effect of how and people tell me it can't be done, but Trump will be president for a third term or longer because he'll declare martial law. What the hell? You know, things are really screwy, you know, and anyway, we're going to have a really strange show tonight, all right? We're going to talk about this. We're going to talk about the Mandela effect. We're going to talk about time travel. You know, I've got my friend Amanda Curran, who does the news. She's going to be on with us talking, and Debra Jain East is going to be on with us talking. And in the second hour, we're going to have Bronxville Paranormal visiting with us to tell us what's going on with them. You know, we're also going to have open lines on the first hour, and I'm going to do that fairly shortly. But I do want to talk to people about what they think is going on here. Soon I'm going to have this going on. That's what I forgot to tell you. If you go to blackswampradio.net, I have the callback button back on the page, so you can call during the show, during open lines, and you can just call me on Skype. We do have a phone number, though, and I will give you that if you want to write down a phone number. I'll give you that. I don't use Angel's phone. Okay, I don't use his phone number because I can't have two different Skypes up on a crappy system that I have. It just doesn't work. So the phone number is 419-464-7272. And when I get ready to open up the lines, I will give out that phone number again if you didn't catch it the first time. It's been a really nice week. I got the pool closed. I dropped a few trees. I mean, one of these trees is so big that I am going to make several tables out of the trunk. it's like 4 feet in diameter. It's the biggest tree I've ever personally felled in my life. But things are getting pretty interesting. Amanda, are you there? Amanda?
I am here, sorry. Trying to get the mute button off.
Too
many pages. Too many pages.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, first, you know, what I wanted to talk about here, too, is the fact that I was telling Amanda a few days ago, I guess it was, that it's gotten to the point where we need donations for the station to keep it running. You know what I mean? There, Amanda.
And we know what you mean.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
We're here all
This computer, I haven't shut it off. I told you guys about it last week. I haven't turned it off. All right? And the other computer, it's giving me crap, too. It's died on me like twice. I need two computers. I don't have to get brand spanking new computers, people. I need help, though. The server's coming up. And guess what's going on? Do you know about this crap, Amanda? The browsers are updating to the point where next year, if you don't have a certificate on your site, and you need to listen to this, Mr. Angel, because it goes for you too. But Angel can afford to do it. If you don't have a certificate on your site, the way the browsers are working now, they're going to check every site that they go to, and if there's no certificate, they're going to issue you're going to get that page where a warning page that said this is an unsafe site unless there's a certificate. This will always be a safe site. I don't care what warning were to come up in the future. There is never anything wrong with this site. I personally make damn good sure about it, and it's also scanned frequently. Daily, as a matter of fact. But that certificate is like $500, and that comes out of my pocket. If people really enjoy Black Swamp Radio and the shows that we host on Black Swamp Radio and the future shows, you know, we have old time radio and stuff like that, and we're going to have more in the future. If you really enjoy this kind of stuff, I know there's some people that just like the old-time radio and some people that just like listening to the Mallard Report and Debra Jain East's show and my show. And then there's people who like the music, and that's all they like. But if you really like this stuff, please help us. Help us stay alive. You know, I mean, this is my responsibility, but it would really be nice if people would help me with it. And so anyway, I know I just need that help. So anyway, Amanda, I'm going to go ahead.
Do you know details? Someone just asked in the chat room what kind of specs are needed for a computer.
What kind of specs do I need for a computer?
Well, I don't know if that's in regards to getting a certificate. I don't know. Pat, if you want to elaborate.
Well, a certificate goes on the server. And on whatever server you use, like GoDaddy. If you call GoDaddy and you ask him about it, I'm not bull crapping you. Mm-hmm. I'm not giving you a lie.
No,
I'm not talking about you, Amanda. But I'm not pulling a line of crap to anybody here. If you go to, like, example, if you go to GoDaddy and you call them on the phone and you ask them about this, they're going to tell you about it. They will tell you that you need to do this if you want anybody to be able to go to your site. I heard this, I talked about it last year. They said it was rumored last year, and Lucky, you know Lucky. Lucky told me about this 2 weeks ago, and I kept forgetting to tell people about it. Because Lucky doesn't have the money either for his site, so he's just going to let his site go. At least that was the last report. But what I need... I need a Pentium 4 or better for a computer, for my server computer, and something with XP on it or better. I don't want something with Windows 8. I don't want something with Windows 10. Windows 7 works. But anyway, it doesn't have to be a brand new spanking computer. It can be something, you know, that's used and refurbished with a decent sound card and all that kind of happy stuff. So But anyhow, before me and Amanda start talking, and Debra Jain will be coming on around 10:30 or something like that, I am going to play the news, and Amanda did a good job with it tonight, and you need to hear it.
Well, you guys can be the judge.
Yeah, let everybody just be the judge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is News from the Swamp. I'm Amanda Curran. Exciting news will be revealed by NASA this Monday, and though not many of the details have been released, the space community is in high anticipation. The press conference will focus on one of Jupiter's larger moons, Europa, and the activity that may be related to the presence of a subsurface ocean. Scientists have long suspected that the moon has a vast, salty ocean beneath its crust, and theorize that if this is true, the chemical balance of Europa's subsurface oceans would be remarkably similar to the ones here on Earth, suggesting enough hydrogen and oxygen for life to form. Researchers even suggest that this hidden ocean could potentially hold 2 to 3 times the amount of liquid water as Earth does. To learn more about Europa, check out a short video at our Facebook group at Black Swamp Radio. Next week, Elon Musk will also be making an announcement on his plans to make humanity a multiplanetary species. Again, while few details have been revealed, some tweets have many speculating. One of Musk's latest tweets reads, "Turns out MCT can go well beyond Mars, so we will need a new name." The tweet has many believing that the Mars Colony Transporter, which will be able to carry 100 people or 100 tons of cargo to Mars, and that the new name of Interplanetary Transport System reflects that the craft will now be able to get us to Mars in a matter of days rather than weeks and beyond. Musk is still hoping for his first official launch at the end of 2017 and the first mission to begin in 2018. If you've ever wondered why NASA has so many press conferences to outline their mission plans and processes, this next story may shed some light. Last Wednesday, after the launch of their second space station, China had to admit that they not only lost complete control over their first space station, but also had to issue a warning that it is expected to re-enter Earth's atmosphere in the later part of 2017. Deputy Director of China's Manned Space Engineering Office, Wu Ping, explained, "Based on our calculation and analysis, most parts of the space lab will burn up during falling, and that there was little chance of any fragments causing damage on Earth's surface or disrupting aviation activities. However, the concern comes from the fact that while most decommissioned satellites or space stations are retired by forcing it to burn up in the atmosphere with a controlled burn and are usually scheduled to burn up over the ocean to avoid endangering people, it seems China's space agency is not exactly sure when the space station will re-enter the atmosphere, implying that the station has been damaged somehow and China is no longer able to control it. Not knowing when or where the space station will make its uncontrolled descent does have the potential to spray populated areas with debris, no matter how slim the odds may seem, and peers in the space community fear China will not admit there is a major problem until the last minute." A newly discovered Latin text book on mathematics, dating back to the 18th century, now has ufologists even more convinced that aliens have in fact been visiting us for hundreds of years. A treatise on mathematics by Joanne Casper Funk features a wood-carved illustration on its cover, clearly depicting a UFO. Believed to have been printed in 1716, the front cover outlines a flying saucer shown emerging from clouds in the sky, surrounded by lightning bolts over choppy waters. UFO enthusiasts take this as proof that sightings have been witnessed and chronicled throughout history, and that even 300 years ago, there is still a major consensus on what an unidentified flying object looks like. In related news, a new article has been published after former astronaut Leroy Chow, who logged nearly 230 days in space, went on record earlier this week stating, "I believe there is life all over this universe, since it would be the height of arrogance to think that we are alone," and is now not only making claims of people having made contact with these alien beings from all across the U.S., but has even listed some of the best locations to visit when trying to communicate with extraterrestrials. Researchers say while California has the highest number of reported sightings, they say Nevada still holds the most compelling evidence that we are not alone. On the list are the extraterrestrial highway in Sand Spring Valley, Rachel, the UFO capital of the world, and of course Area 51. Have aliens really been visiting us for centuries, or have they yet to arrive? And if they do visit, would you travel to Nevada in an effort to meet them? Visit our Facebook page at Black Swamp Radio and let us know what you think. I'm Amanda Curran, News from the Swamp.
Oh, yeah, I forgot. I have to unmute. Anyway, yes, that's something I forgot to tell people. I added a bunch of people. Amanda added a bunch of people. And we made a group, a Black Swamp Radio group on Facebook, and it seems to be working. And
I personally like the groups better than the pages. I find the groups come up more often, and that way members, like, I don't know, a page you follow, but you're a member of a group, and you can post and comment, and it's more interactive, and I don't know. I personally, what do you guys think? Tell us in the chat.
Tell us in the chat.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that the group is going to work out just fine. But what about that state that news report you had about the Russian space station that's going to be falling on falling to pieces? Or China? It's Chinese. You know what? It brings me to mind. Have you ever seen the TV show Dead Like Me?
I never watched it, but I know the show you mean, yeah.
Well, it's on Comet TV this month. You know, they're running it this month. I love the show Dead Like Me. But the whole basis of the TV show from the very get-go, when the girl becomes a Reaper, is that she's standing there on the sidewalk, and she looks up, and there's this toilet seat that the Russian space station, you know, started falling apart, and it started just falling all over the place. Well, she got killed by the toilet seat of the Russian space station, and they always called her Toilet Seat Girl throughout the show. And
that's a road to eternity.
So that's what this reminds me of. I mean, you know, where fiction comes into reality, it seems to happen quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Well, don't get me on a rant about predictive programming, but see, well, because, I mean, I don't know. Well, I know I talk a lot about space and stuff, but, like, usually, like, when they know, okay, we're going to retire a spacecraft or a space station or whatever, they know. Like, they try to aim it over a large body of water. So, you know, if it doesn't all disintegrate, it just falls into the water, right? China doesn't even know when it's going to hit the atmosphere and burn up, let alone where. So, you know, like, what if that was, like, right over a major city? Like, what if that's, like, right over a country? Like,
well, what do you think? You think it could be a cover story? You know, for something else, they know that's going to hit the atmosphere next year or something?
I think it's worse than they're telling us. I think it's a lot worse than they probably knew for a lot longer. And because they just launched their second in history for China, their second space station. And that's why they said, by the way, whatever happened with that first one. And they said, well, it served the 2-year mission that it was supposed to. But I guess, like, it was at 370 whatever altitude. But as it's like decomposing, it starts getting closer to the atmosphere and it's going to disintegrate. And they're thinking it's going to be the later half of 2017. That doesn't give me a lot of confidence, you know. And then they're putting a spin on it, like, well, it did what it was supposed to. Well, yeah, but
yeah, well,
you have absolutely no control over it now.
Well, most of it's going to burn up. That's just common sense.
It's probably not going to be anything, but still.
You know,
knowing that much metal is somewhere overhead, and just waiting to drop.
Well, you know, what can you do? I mean, chances are you're not going to get hit by it.
No, but if they said, you know, it's going to hit this time next year, most likely over New York, at least people can do something about it, not what are those meteors falling over my backyard?
What do you...
You know, the night of, like...
Well, yeah, the night of. I mean, you got meteors or space junk or what... Really, what are you going to do about it? I mean, it's... At the speed that it impacts, whatever it impacts...
Time, if you know it's going to happen in a few weeks...
Yeah, but what are you going to do?
When
it hits the ceiling of your house, I mean, you don't know where it's going to land. It's kind of like shooting a bullet up in the air. It's got to come down somewhere.
Yeah, but you know, if you're in New York, you could go to, I don't know, what's on the other side, Florida?
You can go down to the subway.
No, sorry, not Florida. I'm on the wrong
Florida.
Sorry, Washington.
See, you can tell she's from Canada.
No, what am I? Hold on. Canada. Oh, my God. Never mind. I'm not doing geography anymore.
It's okay.
But speaking of which, if you wanted to talk about the Mandela effect.
Yes, I do. I want to talk about the Mandela effect. Go ahead.
I actually found a few things last time we talked about it. Some really good examples that I had forgotten, and then I heard two more, and I haven't verified them yet. But and one was about missing continents that used to be on a map, or people claimed places they had visited that no longer exists. And I had heard about it before, but I couldn't remember the details. So I actually wrote something down. There is a landmass besides Australia, and it was like, if you're looking at a map, it was on the left or on the west side of Australia. But if you actually go to the movie Dazed and Confused, the movie was supposed to be set in the 70s, but it actually came out in the 90s, you can actually look at a globe. In the background, there's a scene where the hippie chick and the guy with the curly hair, they're looking at a globe, and you can see that landmass to the west of Australia clearly in a few frames of the movie, but you can't find it on a map or like Google Earth or whatever. How weird is that, eh?
That's weird. I was telling you earlier, what happened to me was I got this tattoo, right, guys? I got this tattoo by these two tattoo artists. One, they're pagan, and they're called Bear and Mother Nature. No relation to Bear from the chat room in the swamp. But Mother Nature put this tattoo on me. And, well, I burnt my arm last week really bad while I had a bonfire out back, burn up a bunch of brush and whatnot. Well, I ended up peeling off the skin, and stuff like that, and so on. But the whole Mandela effect thing that I'm getting at is that Bear, I specifically remember Kelly's sister and Kelly telling me that Bear died, and I remember going to Mother Nature in her backyard and giving her my condolences and saying I'm sorry in a whole nine yards. Well, a few months ago, I found out Bear is still alive. And I said something to Kelly about it. I forgot to say something to Kelly forever and ever and ever. And tonight I said something while I'm on Skype with Amanda. And Kelly says, no, he never died. He's always been alive. And they're still living in the same place. So what do you think about that?
I don't know. Too many people. It's happened to me twice where I remember posting stories about celebrities dying and then doing it again a few years later. I mean, it's crazy. It's crazy. But the ones I forgot, you know how we were talking about the Star Wars movie?
Yeah.
And everyone says it's Luke, I am your father.
I remember Luke, I am your father.
And apparently it's changed now to No, I am your father. Okay, now people can say that you remembered it wrong and stuff like this, but I was on YouTube and I found two different videos, both of James Earl Jones, the voice of Darth Vader.
Yeah.
Two completely different interviews, different stations. There was a guy on him with one on one and he was alone on one. And both times he was recounting when he first read the script and he said, I remember reading Luke, I am your father, and thinking, no, he's lying. How are they going to pull that off? And then on the other interview, the exact same story, the exact same wording, but I mean, he's been telling the story for like 40 years now, right? Yeah. But again, he says, I remember reading the line, Luke, I am your father, and thinking there was no way. But every time he says it, he's the one that read the script. He's the one that said the line. It's an iconic line. And every time he says Luke, So why is it now no? How could everyone, including the actor, remember it wrong? You know? But when I was on there, and it was one that I had heard before and I totally forgot, and it's really, really cool. C-3PO from the movie.
Oh, yeah.
Apparently the color of his leg.
Yeah, the color of his leg. Because he was built originally C-3PO was built out of scrap parts, so that's why he had a different colored leg. Because he
was
built out of scrap.
When I think of him, I remember him as being all gold. And, I mean, I heard the stories that he's nice and shiny at the beginning of the movie and then somehow gets dirty throughout the movie, so because it was too hard to film at the time with the metal reflecting or something. Uh-huh. So I've heard stories like that. Well, I've seen, like, part one when he was being put together, but I don't remember it. Seeing all these pictures, it looks so weird.
I don't remember that either. I don't remember the silver leg deal up until the time that you pointed it out. I didn't remember that. I had vaguely remembered somebody else telling me that, but up until then, he's always been solid gold as far as I was concerned too.
Yeah, and then I'm looking back and I'm seeing these toys and these coloring books and these posters, and yes, I mean, there's all the silver leg there, but, you know, and I was thinking, like, okay, there's the proof, but then I was looking at shirts, like Star Wars t-shirts, that on the shirt it says, Luke, I am your father. Now, me and you misremembering a line from a movie incorrectly is possible. Manufacturers of billions of shirts misquoting one of the most, you would think, iconic lines of all times? How? How is that possible? How can I go out and buy a shirt that says, Luke, I am your father, if that was never the line? I mean, that's what I mean. You can say you misremembered things, but, and it's like the Bernstein Bears. You can't find a picture anywhere that says you can't find a picture anywhere that says Bernstein Bears. It all says Bernstein, but it doesn't even sound right saying out loud. I mean, and like Curious George, why would anyone draw a monkey without a tail? You can't find a picture of him with a tail. I've seen people in like Halloween costumes and stuff of Curious George and the man in the yellow hat, and the costumes have tails, but you can't find a picture from the book with him having a tail.
Yeah, I remember Curious George with his tail.
Well, he hangs from trees. He's a monkey. I mean, how could he not have a tail?
Yeah, why would a monkey not have a tail? That's kind of stupid.
But I remember him. Like, I mean, a lot of the pictures, he's up higher than the man in the yellow hat. He's in, like, a window ledge or on a sign or in a tree or something. And, yeah, I know monkeys can climb, but, I mean, it just seems like he would be hanging from his tail trying to grab the hat or something, you know? Like, I don't know. It's so weird. But now, there are two that I just heard about, and I haven't checked them, so I don't know if they're true, but let me know if you guys have heard this. In the movie Silence of the Lambs, have you heard this yet?
No, I don't think so.
When the woman walks into the jail and Hannibal Lecter meets her for the first time, what does he say?
Hello, Clarice.
Apparently that line has been edited.
Oh, jeez. Hang on here.
Okay. Do you want to...
There we go. Hang up. Go ahead there. Hang on there, Debra.
I think we're all connected.
Yeah, we're all connected. It's my fault. Go ahead and finish what you were saying.
Yeah.
Amanda, go ahead and finish what you were saying about Hannibal Lecter, and because I cut you off.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, like that's one of the most copied lines, like, hello, Clarice, you know? How could it be edited? Why would it be edited? And how could people... if the line didn't exist, where did we all come up with it? It's not a matter of misrepresenting it, or he said, Miss Clarice, hello. It's not like we remembered it wrong. How could we make up a line that didn't exist in the movie? I don't know. But the other one was, apparently now you can see clips of the JFK assassination with six people in the car instead of four. And again,
that was freaky. I saw that.
I have not seen that yet. And we have Debra Jain East visiting us now. And she's Notes from the Underground, and you can listen to Notes from the Underground at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Or no, excuse me, 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, almost every single night except for Wednesdays, because I got to do my show and stuff. But Yeah, she's
Amanda, you did a great job on the news, by the way, by NASA. That was right on spot. I really enjoyed hearing all that.
Oh, thank you.
So we've got Debra here. We're going to talk more about the Mandela Effect, and we're going to talk about CERN, and we are going to talk about time travel. And so I'm going to throw out my thoughts about what's going on, and then we can all have a little debate here, because
obviously Debra knows what's going on, and she's already seen. I just heard about that story about JFK, and you've already seen it, so I can't wait to hear your theory on it too. So
I haven't heard anything about the six people in the car. It's always been the driver. It's been my memory serves. It's been JFK, his wife, and the driver in the car, and that was it.
The other guy that got shot through the shoulder.
What other guy that got shot through the shoulder?
The governor? Was it the governor?
There was only three people in that car.
I always remember four.
That is strange.
Because there was the driver, and then I don't know if he was the governor or who he was. I don't think he was the vice president. No, I can't remember who it was. But and then behind him was JFK. And then Jackie to his left.
Yeah, but the guy...
And one of the bullets went through one guy's shoulder, and that hit John Kennedy in the throat. And then the fatal one hit him in the head. And he was taken to the hospital, too. And then there was another couple, I think it was the vice president and his wife, in a second car.
I have not heard this at all.
But it looks like it's a second, man and a woman, a second couple.
I have not heard this. The other guy that got shot was walking. He was a security officer walking alongside the car, from what I recollect, what I saw.
I remember one of the Secret Service guys jumping on the back of the car when Jackie was falling from it, and then they sped up. I don't remember anyone walking beside it or someone standing.
There was a security officer on each corner of the car. And when the shots rang out, Mrs. Kennedy, tried to go off the back of the car because the top was open. She tried to climb on the trunk and get off the car that way.
Well, the new one is so different. It actually shows, it looks like she gets the gun and she hides it in her purse. And not only are there more people in the car itself is changed. There is a side little window. It's not a full window. It's just a little side piece that is on this new video that has popped up. And so they have a replica of the car in a museum, it does not have that piece on it. So it is the most bizarre thing I've ever seen.
Do you think this is an attempt to rewrite history so that nobody will ever be able to prove what actually happened?
Well, I don't see what that would do to help anybody. But the one thing that I did read earlier, my thoughts was, well, somebody was saying that it was one of those movies by the Bernstein Bears or whatever the other name was, and it was different, two different names. Well, they actually found two VHS tapes with each different name on it. In the same timeline, they had two VHS copies of this cartoon with the Bernstein Bears, and it had one the way that we remember it, and then the other one was, I think, Bearstein? It was different.
Bernstein, right. Apparently.
Right. Well, there were two VHS tapes with Bernstein and Bernstein Bears. Two different ones. So,
well, that's
that
what I'm reading
right
for.
There was bizarre.
That's what I see, because, the more people rely on the internet for news rather than, books and stuff, say this was all just a big joke to mess with us or something. When Google and search engines and stuff first started coming on, what if any picture of the Bernstein Bears came up and they doctored it? So now in the internet, you can't find it anywhere. But, there's got to be, toys, VHS tapes, books with the actual proof.
Yeah, there's.
But now, if someone's censoring it, because I mean, all like political sites are getting shut down now. I hear. I don't know the details, but like YouTube, if it's anything political, like if you're saying anything was a conspiracy, I mean, grab it the second you find it because it will be gone.
Yeah, it will.
And so, I mean, who's to say? I mean, yes, it would be very elaborate, but I mean, think about what we're talking about here. Well. You know? And actually, I was reading a story about the man from Turad, I think. It was a guy. Supposedly, in the 1950s, he showed up at the international airport in Japan.
And, yes, I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, and he was saying, I'm from this place called Turad. And he got really, really upset when he couldn't find it on a map. And he had a driver's license. And
he had the papers with the correct stamps on.
Yes, exactly. Like this place really existed. And the police brought him to a hotel under lock and guard. And 24 hours later, he disappeared. And like a countrywide manhunt went on. And that's it. And that's all we know about him. So, I mean, if it was like a time traveling kind of thing, which I think is where you're going, Arizona... you know, and I did hear pieces of CERN, and they're saying, like, oh, well, if we do whatever and open a small dimension, it's only going to be a little one, so, you know, nothing's going to fall out. I mean, why would you even say that? Why would you even joke about that? So, I mean, maybe it is altering, you know? And, like, I was thinking, the more I think about it, like, that life is like a box of chocolates is actually life was like a box of chocolates. But the whole sentence is... Mama used to always say, life was like a box of chocolates. And if you think about it, like if you want to get technical, proper writing technical, that sentence doesn't even make sense.
No,
grammatically.
It doesn't. But here is my thoughts on things. Okay. All right. It starts with CERN. CERN, what they're trying to do, what they are doing with CERN, and there's like 10 or 13 from what I understand, what I learned the other day talking with somebody. There's 13 different CERN facilities, and what they are doing is they're running full speed 24/7. They are collecting as much dark matter, dark energy as possible, and they want to weaponize this. But from what I understand from my sources, it is an ET race that is having them do this. But dark energy, dark matter at the size of a pea is equivalent to 3 Hiroshima bombs. Just the size of a pea. I mean, this stuff is so volatile. They have to have gigantic facilities just to confine it. And I can pinpoint to the time everybody remembers. Let me get my thoughts together here. Everybody remembers the tsunami that hit India. Nobody could understand how the plates moved under the ocean in the fashion that they did, and I can explain that to you. When dark matter releases its energy in one place, it also releases its energy in another place. And that was right at the epicenter of that tsunami, of that earthquake. The plates that got pushed up like something blew it up. And from that moment, things started happening. Things started changing.
That really makes sense to me.
All right. Now, major events that have changed, history things like with JFK and so forth. That is the Mandela effect.
Well,
but
the
other things that are going on here is that there's time travel issues. When you time travel and you go back into time and you try to save somebody or you try to change something that's already set in stone, it changes things. If it's a small enough event, things have a way of working themselves out. If it's a big enough event, then things change, like events with what I just described with Bear and Mother Nature, the tattoo artist that did the tattoo on my arm. somewhere along the line, because there's more than just me. I'm not the only one that can do this. And I know of a few others in the city that I live that know how to do this. So something's going on. People are not paying attention to the rules and just trying to be selfish and do things that you can't do it. Because if you save someone's life, for example, then everything changes because that person doesn't pass on. So they affect things, even though it doesn't affect, you don't think it's going to affect anything. Just that person's smile from them walking down the street, smiling at somebody that's thinking of killing themselves that day, and they don't kill themselves because somebody smiled at them. That affects things, and things just grow and grow and grow. And when you put it back to where it's supposed to be, and that person does pass or whatever, then you've got a whole hole that you have to fill of events that will never happen. You have a dead reality.
Well, that's why the movie It's a Wonderful Life could be a warning. It could be predictive programming right there, because that's exactly what that movie was.
I never saw that movie.
If you were never born, this is what would have happened. Well, if someone came back to save you, you'd be interacting with people you might not have ever met. So that's going to impact them and then their families and blah, 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 and it goes on and on. But a really weird, and I think it ties right into what you just said, where if you do one thing here, it affects something somewhere else. You know that place to the west of Australia, that island that has now disappeared off the maps, but you can see it in the globe in Dazed and Confused? That place is where they were looking for Malaysian plane 370 that went back down a few years ago.
That's why the TV show Lost popped in my head.
Because, well, an island that used to be there and now is gone.
The island that used to be there and has moved.
Disappeared off the map, off the face of the earth, and that's where they think it might be.
That you know, the whole time that they're looking for this plane, I'm thinking of the movie Lost. And it's just, I'm just picking up on that. And it's like, I remember what you're talking about now. I forgot all about that. But in school, I remember seeing that on a globe, and we had to figure out what countries and everything. And we did our whole continent thing and geography and all that. And you guys remember that going to school.
Oh, of course.
And then there's that whole states thing. I told you the story about that, Debra.
Yes, you did.
And I don't know if I told Amanda. I don't know if people remember. Some people might remember this story. When I was in third grade, I'm studying for my states test. And my dad even, it's one time my dad actually spent time helping me with my homework and so on. Well, I studied and studied, and I got them all right the night before. I woke up, I took the test when I went to school, and the states had changed. They weren't in the same place. And you know, it's like New Mexico was on the other, was on the eastern side of Texas when I studied for the test the night before. When I woke up and took the test, New Mexico was on the western side of Texas underneath Arizona. And that threw me for a loop. And I can also tell you that cities have moved, in my reality at least, where Kalamazoo, Michigan used to be north and at the most eastern point on the lake in Michigan. And now it's almost to the southern border of Michigan.
Well, go ahead,
Amanda.
Oh, I was just going to say, people remember that Mongolia was a lot larger on the map than it is now.
Right.
And like people in Mongolia saying like this doesn't seem right. So I mean, they'd know. I might not know, but they should know.
So if you do anything other in time travel other than observe, or you go back in time, say I take somebody back in time 100 years, and I go to a restaurant that, you know, the building's still there and there's all these great stories, but it's not open anymore, but I go back 100 years, we go have dinner, we dance, and then we come home, that's not going to affect anything. But if I go back and shoot somebody that I wasn't supposed to shoot, or I get somebody pregnant that I wasn't, that's going to majorly affect somebody. And that's majorly going to affect time. Right?
It's like a domino effect.
Exactly.
If you take a different, if you're going on a trip and you go to your destination one way, then that's one thing. But if you take a small road to the left, it's going to change your whole direction, and you possibly could hit a pedestrian and kill them, on your way to the destination. So what you talked about, Arizona, reminds me one time it was late in the evening, and I thought, well, I'm going to go to bed early. Well, I went to bed early, and I thought I'd slept for a long, long time. I had all these dreams, and I woke up, and it was only like an hour later. And I thought, oh, gosh, I still got a lot more time to sleep. So anyhow, that happened to me over and over again. It felt like it had been the longest time. But when I would wake up and look at the clock, not a whole lot of time had passed, and it was sort of like a glitch in time. But I know that scientists now, they basically consider two possibilities for the Mandela effect that makes sense, you know, to them. But I sort of agree with the second one, and that is that there are parallel universes, which means that, you know, this universe that we're in, that we have a parallel universe where things are different, a different reality, or they believe in multi-dimensional realities. I sort of tend to go with the multi-dimensional because anybody that has seen old movies, do you remember when they had to, the first thing that gave them the idea for making a film was they had these flip books, and the flip books would have, like with cartoons, it would have, say, Mickey Mouse would be in one position, on the next page it would move a tiny bit more, and if they flipped it, it would look like, Mickey was running all over the page. Well, yeah. That's how film is. It's just one after another movement on top of each other, stacked up. But when they play it, it looks like they're moving and walking around.
Right.
Well, I believe there's multi-dimensional universes.
Oh, there is so many different universes,
yes,
out there. You would, and it's kind of like when you go from one universe to the other universe, your light switch might, there might only be one thing different if it's a close enough universe. Think of a rope. You look at the end of that rope, and you look at each strand as a different universe, and the closer that, if you're in the center, the closer that the strands are together, then things aren't going to change that much. But as you get out to the outside of the rope, there's going to be a whole lot of change.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. And, I always thought, remember years and years ago, we heard a lot about things disappearing at the Bermuda Triangle. Mm-hmm. Ships, planes, all kinds of things. I've always thought that there was a opening, a portal, or that was a place that was multi-dimensional, that things could go in and out and disappear and not show up. And that's basically what's going on with CERN right now. They're trying to open up like a wormhole. And the thing about dark matter is that after we get some of that dark matter here, it's sort of like a funnel. We're going to attract more and more dark matter.
Well,
and, you were talking about how powerful it is. Just imagine.
When everything is in a balance, dark matter and our universe, it's all in a balance. It all exists within each other. You can't see it. You can't touch it because of the veils or the whatever you want to call it. I'll call it a veil at the moment. When dark matter, it has to be contained. Where you have a fire that can be contained in this universe, in a dark universe, it is not contained. So in other words, you bring that in to this universe, and if any of it leaks out, it's got to equalize. And what it's like is if you have a piece of paper and you do your watercolors on it, and you make this pretty picture, and you let it dry, and you set it on a table, and then somebody spills a glass of water on it, and everything bleeds Everything bleeds together and it forms something else. Well, that's what happens when dark matter is released in this world. And it bleeds, and it doesn't just bleed in a straight line from, let's say, the forward to the future and the past, but it also bleeds into other dimensions and universes and into the dream time, and it's like a ball, and it just goes whoosh.
So you're saying it's like an exchange, like. As we are getting an amount of dark matter, an equal amount of what we have is escaping into this other dimension, sort of.
Exactly. Because it's all, okay. If this were used as a weapon, if you took any decent amount, let's say, all right, if you have a pea-sized part of dark matter, thing of dark matter, I'm not sure how to explain this, I'm trying to, but you increase that. Let's say you have a softball sized amount mass of dark matter and you release that, that's going to take out from here, that here to Pluto and the sun and everything else. And that's going to infect, that would affect the entire universe when something like that turned out missing. Because there's all this space gone, and it's got to do something.
Well, it certainly is an odd thing to be, even to be reading about this, because at first I thought somebody's just pulling our leg. You know, maybe these companies decided to sort of move on with the times and change the names of their products to make it more hip or, you know, to more blend in with this time period. But it's not just names being changed. It's actually physical stuff. One of the things that just blows my mind away is some of the 9/11 videos. You know, I've watched a lot of them in investigating about 9/11, and I've saw some of them probably dozens of times looking for stuff. Well, I found one that I've looked at probably 15 times, and now looking at that same tape, there is a black object that falls from the second tower, and I cannot tell what it is. People that look at it say, "What is that?" And this is physical stuff. It's not just name changes. So I sort of think it's like you're talking about Arizona. It's sort of like on a slow roll. It's like the farther we go along, the more changes and effects, you know, that we may be able to see.
Yeah, we're mucking things up to the point where it's affecting it's going to affect the universe. And someone's going to step in and stop it altogether.
I hope they do, because I've heard rumors, and actually I have saw some evidence that I'm investigating that CERN may have already opened a portal and that things are going on over there. I'm sure y'all saw the images of the sky, just like I saw a few images. The sky was like dark purple, and it was just the weirdest looking sky I've ever seen in my whole life. Now, that in itself, you know, it's not all that unusual, but this was such an odd shade of purple. I mean, I've never seen anything like it. So what if they have? What would we do? I don't think anybody would know, not even them.
I just recently heard the craziest theory about 9/11, and it's so funny because it's so touchy and it's such a sensitive thing, but there's just too many unanswered questions, and maybe I listen to too much conspiracy that I just don't really believe anything anymore. But I mean if they're lying to us on one aspect, what else aren't they telling us? And I don't know.
Well, they're lying.
Oh, there's lots. There's lots.
If they're going to have Hillary Clinton lookalikes go around and campaign for her.
They did it with Paul. They can do it with her.
You know, I mean, they're going to do that and they're going to lie to you. when they're going to turn around and try to get someone like Trump to be your president, when Trump doesn't have any business being anybody's president either.
You know what? I mean, I could be way off, but I'm going to say it here so you can mark it down. We still have, well, you guys still have a shot at Bernie Sanders being your president. Well, what if Hillary dies before she's sworn into office? What if? Then everyone that hates, well, I mean, he would have the most votes after her. He was screwed out of the election and did nothing and then turned around and endorsed her. So maybe he knew something was coming up. And then everyone who either hates or fears Trump, you know, like women, immigrants, all those automatically by default will vote for Bernie Sanders. So,
well, I look at it like this. I can't say what anybody else is going to do as far as Trump and Hillary is concerned. I mean, I'm going to vote for state and city. When it comes to the presidential vote, I'm going to leave it blank. I'm not voting for either one of them. That's just
my answer. I don't want to get into the Hillary lookalike and 9/11 because you have guests coming on shortly and it's just too much. But Debra, I'm wondering, yes, some of the things you're saying, it's like listening to myself with an accent.
Hey,
I just heard about this JFK thing. You already saw the video and told me the details. I mean,
oh yes.
Spent so much time looking at that 9/11 and then that Hillary stuff last night I was hearing about, and I don't know. Have you heard, like, I mean, I had heard before that, like, all the video footage was doctored and, like, the whole nose out hitting the building and stuff. Like, if a plane really hit the building, it would have disintegrated, but you can see the nose of the plane coming out the other side of the building in some things. Like,
yes.
Like, yeah. They put an image over it and misaligned it.
Yeah.
But then people started saying, well, but people are saying they saw the plane. And people are saying, you know, oh, maybe it was a missile and we thought it was a plane. Maybe it was, you know, maybe they were actors, blah, 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 blah. The latest theory I heard is that the planes were holograms.
Oh, yes. Yeah. No, I heard that. I heard that, yeah. Probably that makes years sense. Ago. That, years
really?
Ago.
That's crap.
I just heard that one.
I heard that, and I think that it's crap. However, there is something weird that goes on, because if a plane smashes into a building, it's not going to come out the other side. I don't care how fast it's going on a building that size.
Well, so, there would be debris. Did you notice in the Pentagon and in the towers and the other plane that crashed that there was hardly no plane parts?
But they had a perfectly intact passport with the name and picture.
Right.
Yeah. And, I know, eh? Right, yeah. On top, yeah, of the 110-story pile of rubble.
And with hundreds of cameras around the Pentagon, they only had one that they showed. And you couldn't really tell what was in that.
It was like
video.
A frame by frame with half of them missing.
Yeah, right.
But
so
I've heard
a lot of things.
I've heard stories of people thinking they're seeing cities over Tokyo and stuff. And
well,
saying,
this
is
holograms. It's holograms. Just
so
go
it's
on
possible.
YouTube. Yes. Oh, go on YouTube and look up Tupac Shakur. I believe that's his name. I'm not all hip with, but. There is a concert, and he is a hologram.
Yeah, I remember that.
You
happening.
Saw that? Well, yeah. I saw a hologram the other week, and it frightened me. I saw a family, and they were bent down at, like, SeaWorld, and they had a child, and the child kept on getting close to the water, and there were whales and stuff coming up. And finally, that child walked right over, and I thought, oh, my God, that whale could eat that child. But the father just went out and they acted like they were, you know, touching the whale. Then it jumped up and splashed. It was a hologram. And, you know, I study special effects. I mean, I used to watch all the monster movies and werewolf movies. Mm-hmm. And I loved all the directors who did all of their makeup and stuff. I was totally fooled. I couldn't tell the difference. So, yes, they have the hologram technology. They can use that. But real quickly, I have to tell you what my Mandela effect story is. I remember a few years back when they were saying our population was 9 million people. Well, guess what? I looked up the world's population, and it says it will soon be 7 billion. Now, and there's other people that have seen this too. Where have a billion people went to?
Yeah. I remember. I remember the same thing. I do.
Good.
I remember.
Crazy.
You're not crazy. I remember the same. And even Art Bell commented on the fact that we were at 11 billion people or something, or whatever number it was that you just gave. That's where I learned that, was listening to that man that night, is that we jumped to that, officially jumped to that number of people. And I wasn't aware that it dived back down and changed. How, Debra, if you want to stick around and listen and maybe have a comment or something, for a question for these guys, I'm having Bronxville Paranormal on here in a minute. So get ready, Al and Brian. And that's just fine. Amanda, if you want to stick around and listen and maybe ask a question or whatever, that's just fine too. You know, I got to apologize to people because I wanted to actually take calls and stuff, but we ran out of time because sometimes 2 hours isn't enough.
I have loved this. Thank you for inviting me, Arizona. And I want to urge everybody out there to please support this radio station. Arizona has been so kind to allow my show to be broadcast from there, and he is such a fabulous researcher. He has some of the best shows, and I love his music, and
thank
I
you.
Just appreciate the chance. So I want everybody to donate, and Arizona, I'll talk to you maybe tomorrow about a fundraiser that I just thought of. And I want to say, Amanda, you are just a rocking chick. I'm going to have to send you a friend request.
I was already thinking that earlier. I hope she's on Facebook.
She's a rocking chick. She's got a sexy voice, and the whole nine yards is going on with this lady here. And, oh, by the way, I'm asking people to donate, but I never told anybody how to donate. Okay, what you do is you just go to blackswampradio.net and you look for the donation page. There's a couple different ways to donate. And it's PayPal. I'm sorry, that's the only way that I've got to do it. So sometimes that blocks people and keeps people from doing things too. So anyhow, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to add Al. And then I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to add Brian. And so we can start talking about Bronxville Paranormal and the updates of what's going on here. And I see Brian, you're with us, and Al, you're with us. Hello, guys, and thank you for being here on Swamp Gas and the only paranormal radio station with a frog in a blender that don't fart.
I'm using a double tonight.
You're using
Hello,
a double?
Everybody.
How could anybody
Great
use a double and look like you?
Great conversation.
All righty.
Hi, Brian.
I wish
hi.
I had a double.
Hi, Amanda. Hi, Arizona.
Hey.
Everyone.
So, all right. So, I understand that you guys from Bronxville Paranormal, you can check them out on Facebook. And they're also in, Al and Brian both, I believe, are in my Black Swamp Radio group.
Yes, we are. Thanks for adding.
Yeah, you're very welcome. I knew you guys would sign up and join up because you're on here all the damn time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Always willing to lend a hand, Arizona.
So what you want to start about your updates here? Some paranormal ghost hunting, EVP work or something that I vaguely remember. I was in the middle of stuff today, making dinner and stuff. Al, I'm sorry I didn't get the whole nine yards.
That's okay, because I was driving, and you know I live up in the mountains, so I'm never able to finish a conversation with anybody, so it doesn't matter. yeah, Bri. I mean, you know, anything you want to start off with in particular, Bri?
Well, I've never been up to the Stone Chamber, so our first, you know. We're into the high strangeness as usual, and we started doing some investigations in some of the stone chambers that litter the landscape of New York and a lot of New England, northern New Jersey, and Al introduced me to them over there, and we just started doing primarily just investigating as scientific as possible. I have a Geiger counter now, and we've been using that at this point. I've got the person's name, Al, the researcher that says the Geiger counters or there's a little radiation
David,
release.
David Roundtree, I believe it is the one who says whenever you open up a portal or something to that effect, the radiation levels go through the roof.
Yes, it does. I can tell you that.
Yeah.
And so what we've been doing is we've been going out and going like just a pair of us going because Al was doing some recuperating from his he had a knee replaced with a bionic knee.
Really? How's that working for you, Al? Knees.
And we were catching well, Al's been to these places before, so you got a picture. These are. In the same realm of Stonehenge, probably just as old, if not older. Linda Zimmerman came out with a book recently, and she's giving a lot of the attributing a lot of the stone chambers build to Native Americans. But I got to be honest, I think it goes well past Native Americans.
From what I understand, I thought it was Vikings.
Yeah, well, you know what? The Native Americans actually say that the chambers were here when they got here, so they're not taking credit for it. I mean, it's just her theory. She thought, you know, they had the time and the manpower to actually build them. So that's, you know, that's what she's leaning towards. It's just a theory.
It's an interesting theory, and I can see how maybe some of them were built or mimicked by some of the Native Americans, but you're talking about pretty heavy stone. Moving it, sophistication involved on ley lines, and aligned with each other. So some explorer or group of explorers must have known a lot more about it, and very reminiscent of Europe. They definitely knew where their ley lines were there.
And the astronomy. They definitely knew their astronomy because they all line up to the summer solstice and the winter solstice and the equinoxes and everything else. So they knew astronomy as well.
So some people, I've heard some people say Egyptians did this.
Well, we went through a whole list of names while we were in there. And if you go in with night vision goggles or IR camera, UV camera, anything like that, and you look at the walls, you'll get symbols that just pop up out of nowhere. And Brian, I thought they were runes, and Brian tried to decipher them. Brian, what did you get when you deciphered them?
I wasn't ready for that, but...
I'm sorry.
No, it's no problem. I got to go actually find them.
If you don't have it off the top of your head, that's fine. I mean,
Roughly, I was looking at it, and it's kind of like a combination of different runic languages. Using a multitude or some old and some new, and it basically was a place at one where we found the ruins written on the rock. It was a place of movement or not fire but of power, and that's what it roughly translated to. I'm gonna go try to look for the actual translation that
Norse?
I got out of it.
Were they Norse runes or?
I kind of like was when I was looking for what they had there, I was looking around for the symbols. I'm not versed on all the runic symbols that are there.
Right.
And just going through, you know, just using Google Images, some people do have great ruin alphabets put up there. So it's kind of a partially of Norse, and there was another runic family that was on there, but I'm trying to find the actual, it'll state it on the actual file that I have. Wasn't prepared, I'm sorry. I hope it doesn't towards the final.
Final grade. No, but you know, while we were in there, and we, you know, we use a Tibetan singing bowl all the time in our investigations, and you know, I know that it puts out frequency and vibration, but these things are magical. Arizona, they are magical. Every time we use them, we get great results, and it doesn't matter if we're in the middle of the woods, 4 miles in the middle of the woods, or in these stone chambers, or anywhere, as a matter of fact. But we were going through a list of ancient civilizations, and we had a K2 meter going at the time. And when I touched on the, Brian, help me out here. What was the one I said that made the K2 meter jump off its charts?
That was the Phoenicians. When you mentioned the Phoenicians.
When I mentioned the Phoenicians, the K2 meter just went absolutely insane. And
yeah, it was out of control.
So that was like confirmation?
Well, I mean, you know, I don't know. I mean, you know, we're just throwing names out, you know, these ancient civilizations, and we're not, you know, because, you know, everybody says they're either Celtic or Viking or Phoenicians or something along those lines.
Right.
And we weren't getting any action with anything. But when I mentioned the word Phoenicians, they went through the roof, you know, and it was crazy. And we got a couple EVPs, but the one that really blew my mind was it wasn't so much an EVP, but we were in a chamber that was on an Indian mountain, and I had an experience there once before by myself where I felt a woman's hand touch my arm, and I seen a young Native American girl in my eyes' mind. And I asked her how many chambers were in this location, and I got 17 taps on my digital voice recorder. But the day we were in there,
I don't mean to interrupt, Al, but mention that you were with a couple of the people and they heard certain things as well.
I actually took a group out with me to the same particular chamber, and one of the people who came wasn't supposed to even be there, and she was in this chamber, this woman, and she heard guitar playing. No one could hear it but her, and they actually came out and got me, and they said, Al, you know, you should go in here. She's hearing guitar playing. So I was in there, and she's saying, yeah, it's coming from this location. I couldn't hear any guitar playing. Then she said it changed over to a bass line. And I go, really? And I had known that her brother had just passed away in a car accident. So after we left the chamber, we kind of just went for a walk, me and this woman. And I said, you know, her brother was in two bands. And the first band he played guitar in, and the second band he played bass in. And I said, do you think your brother came to you today? And she said, absolutely. She wasn't even supposed to be there. She was the only one who heard both the guitar and the bass. And when I brought Brian there, we had two digital voice recorders going, and I was filming with my IR camera, and Brian had the Tibetan singing bowl going, and we were asking all kinds of questions. Then we went back in real time and reviewed everything, and we didn't catch anything on either digital voice recorder, on Brian's or mine. We didn't hear anything. Nothing jumped out at us. But yeah, when we played back the IR camera, and during the playing of the Tibetan singing bowl, you can actually hear like Native American ceremony music going on, like tom-toms playing.
Wow.
And I just sent him the file.
So I don't know why it came out on the IR camera and not on the two digital voice recorders. I can't explain it. It was just mind-blowing.
I listened to Al's voice recorder. I could not catch a thing on it. My actual recorder was way too close to our Tibetan singing bowls, so it was picking up a lot of Tibetan singing bowl. But I just sent the file to you, the audio file of this, and as you go in maybe 30 seconds to a minute, you will start hearing. I enhanced it. You can hear the beating going on. It was mind-blowing.
Yeah, it was mind-blowing.
Something that was just incredible. And it's just bump, 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 bump. It's definitely a rhythm there.
Absolutely, yeah.
Amazing. I started analyzing it. There's 40 different rhythmic beats there. And the best part about this, which really kind of validates it, I have a video from before this and just after this. And it's not an artifact on the camera whatsoever. Camera's working fine. It wouldn't just all of a sudden have a problem with it.
Right.
But I also listened to some of the audio thereafter, and I was catching some EVPs on there. And Al asked, you know, what do they call you? What's your name? And we got Sandwick, or Samwick, as in Samwick. Then at another point, Al says,
these are all in different chambers too. This is all didn't happen in the same chamber. We actually hit, I think, three chambers that day. So
And another one, he says, would you like us to leave? And there's a clear yes, 100% yes. But in the chamber that we were in, where we started getting the drums, I did get an EVP, and I'm trying to, you know, with EVPs, they're so low, you have to hear them with headphones on. Mm-hmm. But we got a nice one where I'm talking, and is there anything else you'd like to say before I hang, you know, but before I shut down this recorder? You can talk in it, and it waits about 3 or 4 seconds and says, yes, I have something to say. So I'm trying to get that audio up. It's just so faint that when you try to enhance it, you're getting a lot of extra hiss. Right. In relationship to that audio. But I'm almost close to getting you the translation that I had.
And Brian's got it.
How do you guys get access to all these places?
They're on either state property or public property. They're on the side of the road. You know, Amanda, it's amazing. They're on the side of the roads. They're in the middle of the parks. And they could be in the middle, on the side of the road, in the sun, or in a park underneath a canopy of trees. And they're all the same temperature, like 58 degrees. And it doesn't matter if they're in the sun or not. They're all 58 degrees.
Okay. I'm going to play this for you. All right. I'll play this a couple times if you want. How long is it? Oh, it's 4 minutes.
It's long, but if you go about, you know, let it run for about a minute and a quarter, and you'll definitely hear it.
For about a minute and a quarter, huh?
Or go in 10 seconds and
in Arizona.
Yeah. Your show.
Yeah, well.
This is the beat.
I don't know why it didn't get picked up on the digital voice recorders, but it was just strange. I mean, and it goes through the whole thing.
Yeah, well,
and it's very Native American, you know, or Native.
So all we're hearing is the beat here. Is there anything else?
You hear it to Tibetan singing bowl. Yeah, and you hear that like drum beat underneath it through the whole thing. It's very strange.
Well, it sounds kind of like its own little beat in the beginning, but then as the singing bowls get higher pitch, it almost seems to mimic what a heartbeat sounds like, just for the little bit I heard.
And what was very interesting about this is, if you look at the Native North American Indian people's culture, or most of these cultures, when they do their drumming sessions, it is to mimic heartbeats. This is a Ninda Mountain. It's definitely had natives on the property, and it was is rather strange to get this. I really wish we heard this previously, you know, like when we were there, but we didn't, because we would have investigated even further on that. But while we were there, we also had another encounter with something totally different. we were having an interaction with we heard tree knocks, and then the next thing you know, we are outside on a slab, which is a little bit further away from there. Almost looks like a sacrificial type of mound, or where you would do some kind of priestly work. And we were getting a whistling action. Now you have to understand something. This is the woods, summer. Kids in the area. There was a couple of people in the area, some kids. Not a sound from wildlife.
Nothing from wildlife at all. Birds. No nothing.
No birds, crickets, frogs. Nothing. But when we were doing this, our EVP work within the chamber, Al's looking at me. I didn't understand it at the time. He says, "I heard a tree knock outside." So I'm like, okay, maybe it was some of the kids there. But then when we walked around just for a little bit higher up, we started doing the tree knocks, we did the whoops, and we got a whistle return. And the best part about this was it started moving around us. and it would move pretty quickly. So if I'm facing east, it's moving towards, you know, the north, right. And then it starts moving to the west, and it circles around us. It is responding to every type of call we give it, and it was very intriguing. The whole place was, for the first time visiting it, was really amazing.
Yeah, I think after we started with the Tibetan singing bowl, I think the whole atmosphere of the woods changed, because I took Brian to this like sacrificial area that's directly behind the chamber. It's directly behind the chamber, and there's actually, it looks like an obelisk that may have been standing at one point, like a standing stone, really, really huge, but it must have fell over, because it just there's no way a stone like this happens naturally. And the whole place just changed. In 1 minute, this tree knock or these whistles is coming down. It's coming out of the holler below us, and the next minute, it's up above us on the ridgeline to our west, and it's just all around us, just like whipping around us, like just going around us in circles, and like, well, we're standing there in amazement. We can't believe it.
My question, the action we're getting. One of the questions I have is, what made you use a singing bowl in this sort of activity? I am familiar with singing bowls used to open chakras and for certain meditations and rituals.
Because every time we use this Tibetan singing bowl, we have amazing stuff happen. And we wanted to try it in the chamber to see if we could open up a portal or a different dimension. And when we went in there originally, and Brian checked the chamber out with the Geiger counter. The Geiger counter was very, very low. I mean, almost nothing. And by the time we finished with the Tibetan singing bowl, the Geiger counter was like at danger levels. It was so high, the radiation. And, you know, why would it change like that for no reason in a matter of minutes?
Yeah, and the first time that we really used a Tibetan singing bowl, as you know, Arizona, was when we were at Nuclear Lake.
Yeah, I remember that.
That ramped up the whole situation at that. From that point forward, I mean, you know, you're talking about the moment. Well, we opened the moment. We had the front door key.
Yeah, you did. You opened the moment, so, and you got introduced to things you had no clue about until now.
You know, what's interesting is, we've used this before. With singing bowls, when you get to certain frequencies, you start getting into infrasound areas, and
right.
There's a couple of theories about some of the cryptids out there responding to infrasound, but also infrasound can be used to most like, I mean, that there was a one person used to make like secret locks or puzzles, and they responded to infrasound. You just have to figure out what frequency it is. It opens up. It's like a key.
Right.
So we've had a lot of success with this. When in doubt, you know, use that. It's not agitating anybody. It's just they hear it. They respond to it. It's almost normal for them or for whatever these situations are. For us, I mean, that's why I think Tibetan singing bowls work. When you're meditating, you're opening the chakras.
Well, yeah. You know, everything is based on vibration.
Yep. Well, that's what I was thinking. If you're trying to pick up on a different frequency to communicate, I'm just wondering, like, when, like how I said, when it started, it seemed a little, like, more like it might have been a song or something, and then it went kind of more to like a heartbeat kind of thing, and maybe that's just me trying to, you know, liken it to something in my own mind. But do you find like at certain like. If you start the singing bowls and it gets high pitched, like at a certain frequency, like 5 minutes in, do you get more reaction? And will you try to mimic that certain pitch for like just like get a recording for like 10 minutes straight of one certain note to try to communicate just on that one level rather than it changing pitch
right.
slowly? You know what I mean? I don't know if that made sense.
No, it makes sense. It absolutely makes sense.
Al has a bowl that I think it's the third eye chakra, and we use that at Nuclear Lake. I have a bowl. I have a couple of different bowls now, and they represent different areas, other chakras. Mm-hmm. But there happens to be an app, which is pretty good. We're going back to apps, but it makes it possible to have a full spectrum, about 15 different chakras or sounds or tones. So we were thinking about going back and literally just focusing on one tone, seeing what the results of that would be. Then you'd have to leave there, go back and try another tone, because we don't know if the combination of two
has an effect. Wondering if you've done that yet. No, but you're going to?
No, we're going to. It's something that's local enough where we can kind of get to quicker than the most other sites. It'll probably be warmer in there too come wintertime, but we want to test that theory. I don't want to just go there
I would really like to hear what happens, but now would each individual bowl, but it would change though as time went on. The pitch would eventually change per bowl though, right?
Right, because you initially start the bowl up and it has to again ramp up to its potential.
Frequency, yes.
And then right? And then when frequency. It's at its potential, will it hold that one note or will that still change?
No.
It will change because it'll start losing the vibration.
Yeah. Well, when you stop spinning, right? I'm going to try to describe how you use a singing bowl. If you just took that tone and
recorded it for like 10 minutes, so the frequency wasn't changing, so you just had that one tone going long enough to try to, I don't know.
The way a singing bowl works.
Amanda, I don't even think it would take 10 minutes. I mean, the way these things work, we have so much success with it.
No, but if you were trying to have a conversation, though, if you got one and it was clear enough that you could actually have a conversation, that's what I'm thinking. Like, if it keeps changing and, like, it's circling you, and then, like, some people will hear something but not others, like, I'm wondering if it responds to a pitch, but it's, like, kind of muttered until it gets there. And then it starts fading as it starts slowing. Like, that's what I'm wondering. When you hit the peak, is that the essential time? And you're only getting bits and pieces because it's just not long enough. Because it's constantly changing.
The way that a singing bowl works, if you don't know, some people don't know out here listening how a singing bowl works. They are a certain shape. They're made out of brass or copper, or glass. They're ceramic. There are several different things that can be used in a singing bowl, but you have your what do you call the piece that you hit the ball with? I forget.
Is it the striker?
I don't know. You take the striker, and the striker usually has a piece of felt or it has a piece of leather on the striker. You hit the ball, and then you run the striker along the inside, and the ball will hit its frequency. And as you make the striker go around, it'll keep its frequency. And when you pull the striker away from the ball, it'll keep that frequency until it starts to lose it and die down. But you can keep that going for 10 minutes, 20 minutes if you want to. If you think you need to do it that long, usually you don't have to.
Well, one of the things that I have now is I have the ability of a portable infrasound machine or a sound generator, tone generator. So I can actually keep that tone on for as long as I want. I can go to certain frequencies with it. But you want to get to the frequencies that are below 20 megahertz. Mm-hmm. And that's where it starts picking up. Actually, when you get to about 8 to 14, that's those creepy frequencies. They use them a lot in paranormal activity movies. They first started using that actually in The Exorcist. That's why the movie was really creepy. Because the audience was clueless to infrasounds. Mm-hmm. So what we're going to do is we're going to have these recordings, and we're going to be able to go to that sound directly. I don't even have to use the singing bowl if I don't want to. But I can find the note from it, use it, get it to that frequency, and just sustain it. But I can sustain it where I can put it to a distance from away from our microphones, so that it still is going to get that energy, or maybe it's opening up that portal. That's what we're thinking. And we can have that conversation, hopefully in real time, which will be recorded, of course, with video, full spectrum video, and other recorders. Which means that I will be sitting in front of a computer for hours listening to it and watching.
Loads of fun, man.
Brian's got a great ear. I mean, I can't hear anything, and I think it's because I've been playing my guitar for so long, so loud, that I can't really hear anything anymore. But Brian has a great ear. He really can hear, like, the lowest murmur and pick it up and hear stuff and then just clean it up and bring it out of nowhere. And it's just amazing, because I got to be honest with you, I'm just about deaf.
And that's why when I was in my metal phase in the bands, I actually had earplugs in playing.
I did towards the end with the metal. I did.
Yeah. You had to, it was way too loud and I was going to go stone deaf. But I'm picking them up. But the problem, you see, this is the problem with EMF, electric voice phenomenon for anybody that's out there. It is so subtle that you could just pass it by. You will never know it's there.
You have to be looking for it to get it, yeah.
Right. And what's really interesting, going back to your whole Mandela effect, we continue always go back to the old evidence and we just review it every once in a while. We just go through some, we'll pick a file, go through it, see if there's anything else on there. And I keep continually catch new things on it. So it's very bizarre that it wasn't there before, but apparently it seems to be there again. But that's a totally different. That was part of your Mandela thing, which I always found very interesting.
Okay, I got one for you. Listen to this. This okay. is Willow. She's a year old. We're in the back room of the old house. And just as she's speaking, you can hear something else talking in the background. It was just me and Willow in the house. There wasn't anybody else there. The TV wasn't on or nothing.
And I want you.
Play it again.
Oops. That went back the wrong way. Where'd it go? Oh, I don't even know where it went to.
Sounds like Tucker.
It happened so fast, I thought there was a TV in the background. Then I heard Willow and it was over. So yeah. I did hear something, but I didn't realize it was, like, that voice. I didn't realize that's what it was that I was listening to.
I thought it was Arizona.
I lost it. Yeah. Oh, well. We can move on.
Okay.
If I find it again, I'll play it again.
Definitely play it again. Go ahead. No, I was just going to say, when you play it again, I just turned up the headphones a little bit. I'm using different headphones now, and they go right in the ear canal, so it blocks out the other infrasound, children running around, so I can actually concentrate on things. But it's I definitely would love to hear it, because I've had that experience. I've been in my house fairly recently, and my youngest was passed out. She was out. Oldest was at school. No one was in the house. I'm in the bathroom, and I heard my mother saying hello. And my mother's been passed away for about 2 years. Clear as day. I opened the door. I mean, like, it was right there, which was kind of interesting. I wish I had a recorder.
That's what my mom said when I was a few months old. She, like, my dad and her were asleep, dead asleep, and I was in my crib, supposedly asleep, and my mom woke up because she could hear someone talking, and it was coming from my room. And she said
on the monitor?
I don't know. Was it's just a small pre-monitor. I don't even know.
Here we go. Monitor. I found it. This is a different EVP, though. This is a different one.
Yeah, it definitely sounds like a TV on in the background.
Yeah, that one's got the TV in it. I thought that. Shit. That's supposed to. All right, that's my bad.
Anyway, my mom swears that it was her father who had died 2 years before I was born. Coming to talk to me, and she started freaking out thinking that I was going to die, that he had come to take me to the other side, and my dad said, no, I think he's just getting to know her, and, well, I'm here to tell the story, so.
There you go.
Well, it's one of those, my daughters do this all the time, and they're young enough, and actually, they have the ability to do things that people just don't want to even pay attention to or acknowledge. They see things. I don't know if you ever seen some babies. I mean, our kids did this. They just kind of stare up and they're looking at something. There's nothing
cats
there.
Cats do it too.
Cats, dogs do it.
Animals do it all the time. Yeah.
And I get it, because I'm into this subject and this field and whatever. My wife is just like, you're crazy, you know? Like, oh, you're going to your wacko meeting? Yeah, I'm going to my wacko meeting. But I've heard it. And one of the things I've noticed, and I've been doing a lot more, I guess they call, I call it remote viewing or whatever. People are going to start hearing that, they're going to acknowledge hearing voices. I mean, names called, their name called, and it's happened. I keep experiencing it every day, to the point where I go back, like, did you just call me? I'm like, no, I didn't call you. It's clear. It's not like you're losing your mind. You're hearing it.
I hear Gabriel's horn all the time. All the time I hear it.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool sound.
My wife is sitting right next to me. She hears it as well. And it's just so strange. It's crazy.
Is it just you two? Because I've heard of towns hearing crazy noises like that unexplained.
No, it's usually just me and her sitting in the living room. And you'll hear this. It sounds like a train going down the street. Yeah. But there's no train tracks in this area. And it's not a 18-wheeler racing down the road, because if it was, we would clearly hear the wheels on, you know, going down the road. But there's nothing there but this loud horn, and we hear it all. And every time I hear it, I always ask her, did you hear that? And she's like, yeah. I said, okay, it's not just me.
You know, it's interesting. I think a year ago, or more than a year, a couple years ago, actually, we were outside of my youngest daughter's preschool. We had a meeting with the teacher, 1:30 in the afternoon, New York City. Where I am in the borough, very quiet in the afternoon. No, not a lot of traffic. I mean, you can hear birds. It's really nice. So we're waiting outside, hanging out there, and I hear something that sounds like a construction vehicle combined with that creature from Lost. You know, that, you know, like sound, like with the turret, you know, like the T-Rex from, you know, that the other movie.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what? And the ground starts moving. Like, I'm waiting for either a plane to go by, or they're moving like a gigantic construction. And it sounds like a horn and grinding. And I'm like, what the hell is that? And it comes and it goes. So my wife heard it. I heard it. Didn't pay any attention. Then I hear the Gabriel's horn stuff. So if you go on YouTube, there's a couple of sounds. And you're going through and you're listening, and in about 7 different places around the world, they had the exact same sound. And it just validates your, like, when you hear these things and people around the world hear them, a lot of people are like, oh, they're nuts. Steve Colbert in Manhattan, he was doing his show. He opened the window. He heard Gabriel's horn. They recorded it.
And he's really? Stephen Colbert? Oh,
yes. Look for him.
I will.
He's in his office, and he opens it up, and you hear it. I'm like, that's Gabriel's horn. That's Gabriel's horn. And people look at me like, what the hell's Gabriel's horn? I'm like, you know, I don't want to go into it because you're going to think I'm out of my mind. But yeah, it's the coolest sound. If you ever heard it, it's really, really cool.
Those are supposed to be the horns that tore down a wall or something? The walls to the city?
That's like four. Yeah, yes. But it's also, if you look at what Gabriel does, it's announcing, you know, the coming, the beginning of the end, you know.
The beginning of change. Okay.
Yes. We'll rapture, say, the whole nine.
The know? Beginning of change. We'll just say
the
change.
Apocalypse. Yes.
Brian, you want to talk about Bob and Ellen's house?
Sure. I'll do that in 1 second. I just want to let you know that I found the translation.
Oh, okay.
And the cool. From the ruins, I translated the four letters from it was fire, transformation, misery, destruction. So I
it sums it up.
Well, I you know, I got this. It was a CHBK. These are the letters, and the last two are reversed, because I'm assuming you take when you see a ruin reversed. I'm not very versed in the ruins, but it would mean the opposite of it. And it originally, if you took the letters of C, it equals fire. H, transformation, egg of life. B, joy, or the opposite is misery. And K, which is protection, regeneration, but the opposite would be destruction or death. So that's where I got a fire, transformation, misery, destruction.
Okay, I actually had a question about that earlier, and I don't know if it's really going to apply, but I'm going to ask anyway. When you think of, like, ruins as letters, and I'm thinking, like, hieroglyphs and stuff, you guys know what I mean by the Bible code, right? Where they take, like, the Hebrew and they play like crosswords or word search or whatever.
Yep.
Have you has anyone ever done that with either ruins or hieroglyphs or any kind of ancient writings in like temples, in pyramids, anything like that? Have you guys heard that? Could you do that? Have you ever thought of doing that?
I don't think they have done that. The difference we have here is how many people use ruins and how accurate is the translation of the ruin? That's one.
Well, if they could have opposite meanings for them all too, right?
Well, you would. Someone's. I don't want to assume. I'm not an expert in ruins, but I'm assuming it's a guesstimate. I don't think there's a Rosetta Stone for ruins that says this means this. Whereas, seriously, when you go into hieroglyphics, we do have a Rosetta Stone, so you can kind of translate that. I would be more interested to see if the hieroglyphics translate, but it's different when you get into the Hebrew end of the letters. He was very complex. Each component of that of every letter has a numerical value to it. So there's a lot of science behind each one of those. And each letter is actually the sum of the same sum of God or the name of God. It's bizarre what they do. So I think you could put letters and numbers, you know, the algorithms would work fluidly. But as far as where ruins are concerned, I think there's too many different interpretations of what that could mean for you to get an accurate, you know, output.
I tend to agree, Brian.
Yeah,
so I'm
sure.
I mean, it would be interesting. I'd like to see it.
Tried if it possible. Somewhere now, so. You know, in the past. So. But I don't know anyone who has, but or anyone, but I'm this sure is- someone has probably come. That thought has probably crossed someone else's mind as well.
All right. I have an EVP that I took out of a funeral home.
Nice.
just because I want to play EVPs because I feel like inadequate here.
Sorry.
What do you think of that?
That's pretty creepy. Especially since it's coming from a funeral home.
That was a funeral home. It was upstairs. It was raining that day. The power was on, and there were several people in the house, but not in that room.
Wow. That's crazy.
So the recorder was left in that room or nearby the room?
My laptop was left in that room. Wow. And it was a room where the girls kept saying they saw a little boy. And I have another EVP down in the basement where we're by the bathroom, and the little boy asked for a drink of water. But we had no little kids in the house. It was all grown-ups. So
that's a good EVP right there. I mean, that's because it sounds like an intelligent type of haunt. Yeah, like it's an intelligent haunt. I mean, is there any history of, like, someone really young passing away there that anybody knows of?
From the best I understand, no kids died there. So I think it's an imprint.
The owner, the funeral director, have a young boy that died?
I think
maybe followed him to work one day?
I think what it is I think it's an imprint. I think the children that were there were abused. Does that make sense?
It does, because it could be that spot where, you know, there's a lot of death there. So there's a lot of good and bad death there.
I mean, who would have kids in a funeral home? Who would have children in a funeral home? I mean, that's.
But what was it before it was a funeral home?
A funeral home. Right now it's a daycare. Believe it or not.
But it was something before it was something. Well,
no, when it was built, for the funeral home.
Usually, the funeral director lived in the funeral home with his family too, though. Back in the day, Arizona, so. You know, there could have been a family living there.
I always have a problem when they take some places like a funeral home and they make them into something else, anything else other than a funeral home.
Well, yeah, at first.
Right now, you know, they have this funeral home that was in business for years. I mean, at least 50, 60 years. And now it's like a healthcare center. And I just think the conflict of interest is so vast and huge. I'm wondering what the statistics of people really getting sick there are. Because I think when you mix death with that, It's just not. It's not gonna work.
Well, knowing how many EVPs I got
just
like,
the sadness. Just the sadness that's experienced at a funeral home. All that negativity, all that loss, all that pain. I mean, that can't be good for any business.
I got like six or seven Class A EVPs out of there. And at first, they tried to rent it out for people to live in. And everybody, whether they believed in ghosts or not, they did by the time they were done living there. And then they threw everybody out and said, no, we're going to turn, we just sold it, we're going to turn it into a daycare. And now there's children in there, and I don't understand how after 6-7 years it's still in business.
Well, if there's a child spirit there and it's playing with the kids, I mean,
it's not just a child spirit.
There's got to be a lot of residual energy there, you know what I mean? Not just children, I mean, all ages.
Yeah,
I mean, what's really crazy is the difference between like a you know, something that's static, it's always going to be there, and like an intelligent haunt versus like the normal replay. And I mean, we've experienced intelligent haunts, and that's pretty incredible. They know you're there. They are so aware that you're there, and you get the reaction and the evidence. We had a house in Pine Bush, doctor's house, out of control. And they, to the point where one of the entities that was there was very upset that we were there and screamed, "Get the hell out!" You know, right. Angrily threw a pool ball down on the table, scared the hell out of one of our investigators there.
I remember you telling me about this. You told me about this incident. You can recap, but go ahead.
Well, I don't want to go back to that, but you know. We were investigating this doctor's house in Pine Bush, and as we're going through the evidence, Al had a couple of associates and friends that he investigated with before, and he invited them up, and because it was a pretty big house. Al was like four stories, right, or five stories.
Yeah, it was four story home. It was humongous.
Humongous, and there's the. One person was using the ghost app and kept asking, were children hurt? Did you hurt children here? And after a while, this thing had enough, and it sounded like they took a pool ball, and this is right outside the pool room that was there, smacked it down. And then you're like, get out, you know, angrily. They knew we were there.
They were not happy with us because at one point, something hit the house. It felt like a car had crashed into the house because the whole house shook. Everybody felt it on every floor. It was just mind-boggling. I mean, a house, you don't understand. This is like a 10,000 square foot home. It's made out of brick, and the whole house shook every single floor. Even the basement. It was just crazy. Oh.
Dude, this is strange. I'm having strange shit go on with my Sam right now. It just went to Jim Mallard's show.
Every time you come on my show, it's this way, man.
Every single time. I just had to change that shit. Okay.
Here's a record, because every show we've ever been on, every show, eventually we got an EVP that night. We had a problem. We heard this. I don't know. Maybe it's us, Al.
I'm sitting here and I'm watching it go through the songs on my Sam, and like it's ready to play, you know. And had it been on auto DJ, it'd have been jumping all over the place.
You know. Well, you know, we aim to please. You know, we always bring company with us. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to ask, do you guys find any correlation between when the spirit passed and whether the haunt is intelligent or not? Like, if they just passed, are they more aware? Whereas if they kind of forget if they died 100 years ago, do you find any correlation? Or
no, I haven't found any correlation with that at all.
Nothing. I think when you pass away, or most likely tragic or in general, and you're going to haunt someplace, I think initially you're in that between the two areas, and we'll call that the ether. And you just don't know what the hell's going on. Am I alive? Am I dead? Why are these people here? How come no one could? It's like that movie Ghost with Patrick Swayze. He can't communicate. Like, I'm here. And then you get pissed off, probably. And then after that, you just sometimes some people are happy to see people, and some people are not happy to see you there. I've heard stories where people go back and dead relatives are there, and it's just a happy, you know, experience. Or someone who's lived in a home their entire life, and then they sell it to new people. We have a friend that bought a house upstate New York, like a farm, and the owner, the previous owner, passed away right in the kitchen, and they know. They just, she doesn't want to talk about it, but they're there. The owner is in the house. They can they smell things. They see things move. But he's more than, I think he's at peace with that at that point. When we were at the doctor's house, I'm trying to explain to another one of the investigators why the doors are off the hinges. We caught an EVP, and it says move past them. So it's aware that we're in the room. Paul and myself were in the room, and it's like move past them. They know that we're there. There was another one where I'm just walking down. It's not an EVP. It's actually visual evidence. And three things scatter out of that way as I'm getting closer. It's almost like a cop's coming to a teen party. They all just bolt in different directions. And it's great evidence, because it's like it's aware that we're there. It's trying to get the heck away from me.
And the same thing happened when we were at Bob and Ellen's house too.
Yes.
Whenever we walked into a room and we're filming with the IR camera and we review the evidence, as we're walking in, you can see these orbs racing out. And then we walk into a different room and the same thing is happening. And it's just, I don't know if it's us in general or what it is, but it seems like whenever we get together to do a cleansing or an investigation and it has anything to do with entities or energy, balls of energy or spirits or whatever, we always seem to have these things on the run. And I don't know why they're so afraid of us, but we get them.
We're
on
big
the
guys
run.
Now.
Well, you must be aware of the cameras too, then, because why couldn't you just set up your equipment and leave the house for a while?
Yeah. Well, actually, when we were in Bob and Ellen's house, we had two IR cameras going and two different rooms. And one in Bob's room kept getting shut off. And we just couldn't understand why it was shutting off. So what I did was I brought both of them in the same room and I aimed them at each other. And I actually had a digital voice recorder that I put on in the lock position, and this thing will run for 72 hours. And we left, and then we went back to review the evidence. The one IR, first we hear a big bang, like someone kicked the closet door open. An orb comes shooting out of the closet, goes straight to the IR camera in the doorway, hits that, then goes over to the digital voice recorder, hits that, and then just starts racing around the room. Apparently didn't realize that I had another IR camera on the other side of the room, and I actually had a laser grid up as well. But you could actually see this thing when it comes at it. And we were actually sitting in that room. We're all sitting in there with the dowsing rods, and you hear a big bang while we were there. Of course, we didn't see the orb with our eyes, but as soon as we heard the bang come out of the closet, the dowsing rods started spinning like helicopter blades. They just started spinning around and around and around. And it was just amazing that this thing had the wherein to know that it was going off, shutting off all our equipment. Like, it didn't want us to have to capture it. And there was a couple of times where I'm walking up one hallway towards one room, just filming and not seeing anything at the time, but when we review the evidence, as I'm walking in Bob's room, this orb is shooting out. I'm walking in Ellen's room, an orb is shooting out, and then we did the same thing in Ellen's room. We set up the IR camera with the laser grid, and the closet door actually opened, and a shadow, but just the top of a person, like it's from the chest up, you see a shadow figure go across the laser grid, across the headboard. And there's a lot more to the story, because Ellen was being attacked and all kinds of stuff was happening there. And we really had to cleanse that house really, really good. And when I spoke to Bob recently, he said the house was nice and quiet, but the last thing he said to me was he got up one night to go to the bathroom and he seen a shadow looking in the sliding glass door. And he thought it was someone trying to break into the house. So he grabbed his baseball bat. And he went out to open the when he put the lights on the deck to see who was looking in, the shadow figure just disappeared. And I told him, you better stay on top of this house and keep it cleansed. And I actually told him he should actually salt the perimeter of the property as well, just to push this thing further away, because it was cleansed once before through numbers, and it came back. And when it came back, that's when it actually, because originally it was just a shadow figure looking in at them. But when it came back, it actually started to assault Ellen, and it really got bad. That's when we came in and we pushed it back out and we cleansed the house. But
this thing is trying to
get back in, and if it does, it's going to be. I fear that if this thing gets back in, you're going to have to actually do an exorcism on the house.
Well, Al, what you do is you go back and you use black salt, and you use limestone, and you use sea salt, and
we use kosher smudge sea salt from the Dead Sea.
Yeah, you smudge. Frankincense, burn that. I mean, you won't be able to stand the smell, but it's frankincense and myrrh. Use both of them.
Yes, I put them in with I actually bagged up little bags of frankincense, myrrh, and sea salt, and I told them to put them in each corner of each room to purify each room.
Yeah.
And even up in the attic and in the basement.
The other thing that you can do, Al, is you can take, if you have a dead cedar tree, cut up the cedar tree and take pieces of cedar and put it in every single corner too.
Yeah.
Cedar works wonderful.
This is an interesting house. I mean, there's a dark history to the house prior to them owning it. And we've kind of come to, it's not necessarily that they're coming there to hurt the owners. It's more like, it's almost like either the entrance or exit. It's almost like Grand Central Station for these beings to appear and then travel elsewhere. And that's why, because
I totally disagree, because the one that was attacking Ellen was not there just passing through. He was physically attacking her and hurting her. And there was more to that than meets the eye. And we had to really dig in to get the history of Ellen. And when we found out, because we were pretty relentless, we actually broke her down and she opened up to us. Turned out that she had come from the old country in Spain, and her family were her family has a history of being healers and helping people. And we kind of just got the vibe that maybe her grandfather and her father were healers, and maybe they did some kind of exorcism on something, and whatever it is back trying to take its vengeance out on her now. Because I do believe that she's got some kind of gifts, and I think that's another reason why everything is attracted to her, to the house, because of her. She's so wide open that, things are going to just come to her. But, you know, not necessarily, you know, evil things, but this thing is definitely evil. And
well, I got to break in here, guys. We can go long. That's fine, but I got to let people that are listening on PSN know, if you want to hear the rest of the show, you need to come over here to Black Swamp Radio and tune in, because it's about that time for me to shut this off. So at midnight, I'm going to turn it off on PSN, and we can just keep on going. All right, go ahead. Continue.
I was
going
to ask before it ends, but I don't know if this is going to be stealing your line or not. Where can we see these videos?
The videos for the doctor's house are actually on YouTube right now. So if you look for Bronxville Paranormal Society on YouTube, it's there. We're getting the stone chambers ready. I keep going back and finding things. So you'll have FLIR video, and you'll see almost like a purple portal open up. And you'll have the audio and all the video for that. And we have a bunch of other things that are coming up. We have We had a glitch with one of the cameras for the home that we were just talking about, where the camera decided not to connect to a computer, and so we're trying to revive that hard drive and pull that information off of it. But we will have all that, the photos up, and audio.
Yeah, Brian's very confident that he's going to be able to get it. I just think that the chip itself is a defective chip, and we can't, we really can't watch it on anything other than the camera itself.
Yeah, so I'm going to have to pull it off that.
But,
yeah, and also BronxvilleParanormalSociety.com. Because all our investigations will be on there.
And you've got your Facebook page, too, guys.
Yes, our Facebook page. Sorry about that.
All kinds of social media pages.
You got all kinds of stuff. You guys are like Black Swamp Radio. You are out there, man. We are out there. We've got so many different places to listen to our show or the podcast or listen to the station. It's pathetic.
That's great, man.
Yeah, I got your YouTube channel posted in Black Swamp Radio on Facebook, too. So for those already there, that's an easy way to find.
We also did a promo for this show on our on BlacksvilleParanormalSociety.com, and it hits Twitter and Facebook and Tumblr and all those social media sites, except for Pinterest, because I don't think too many people would be interested.
No, the hell with Pinterest. Hey, Brian, there was another story that you wanted to get to that you didn't get to.
We got
a
cut.
A lot of stories. We did so much stuff this summer.
Yeah, and, but you said there were specifically two stories. Well, you covered the one, but you never got to the other one. Or
I don't know. I mean, we've done so much stuff, man. We talked about the stone chambers, and we talked about Bob and Ellen's house.
Yeah.
We did another trip to Nuclear Lake, another day trip, and we got some incredible evidence there. We filmed what we have on film. We believe we captured not only a footprint, like a Sasquatch footprint, but we actually think it's a type 3 dogman that's in the den. We actually got a video of that. And, cool. You know, and that's just the tip of the iceberg with the Nuclear Lake stuff. We did a presentation in Red Hook the other night. We were invited up there for a town hall meeting, and we did a couple of C5s. We got invited to go back to Pine Bush next year for another presentation, and they actually put us on the planning committee this year. So we get to pick and choose who we want to have come up and talk and stuff. So, you know, just a ton of stuff going on, man. We haven't even gotten to through half of the evidence on any of this stuff, or even written up any of the reports to put them on the website, which is, we're so backlogged.
How many people are on your team?
We have 6 in general, but we have other people who are out of state. We have a psychic that's out of state. My brother's a parapsychologist. He's out of state. My sister is an intuitive. Again, she's out of state. We have another woman who lives upstate New York, who's the team's editor. She edits and all the reports and everything and posts everything.
She does Reiki too.
Oh yeah, she's a Reiki master too. Yeah. And you know, so I think all together there's like 10 of us, but basically there's only 6 that actually go out on the field, and 7 if you count the psychic, because she's always comes with us via the phone, you know, whether it's FaceTime.
Yeah, she tends to do that.
She's dead on all the time. Yeah. She's really impressive.
I've had Cindy on the show, you know that, and she's awesome.
Yeah, she's working with moi right now to enhance my gifts and abilities, apparently, that I have, and I have about a 98-99% accuracy rate for what I do. I call it remote viewing, but you know,
it's a little bit more than remote viewing, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
it's a lot more than that. I still haven't gotten my lottery numbers.
Let's put it this way: people who weren't aware would be very happy they weren't aware of what you can see.
It's just interesting that when you have this, and someone, you know, says you can do X, Y, and Z, and she's been working with me, and she goes, you have a lot more stuff, but you keep those walls up. And I'm like, yeah, I keep those walls up because when you do certain things, you don't want to open up Pandora's box, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Oh, that shit can make you insane, too.
Yeah, it can, actually.
Yes, it can. So you got to be really careful when you're playing with that stuff, and you got to have a good teacher, a good guide.
Yeah.
Because if your guide don't know what the fuck's going on.
That was the first thing. When we were at Nuclear Lake, you know, I learned grounding, I applied it for the most part, not as well as I should have, but it was very, I knew things were going to happen, but I didn't know exactly what was going to happen. And if I grounded myself properly, it would have been better, but you know,
well,
yeah, you're right about the teacher though.
I'm going to let you in on a little secret about grounding. You need to watch what part of the country you're in when you ground.
Why is that? Just curious.
Well, I'll give you an example. When I'm in Sedona, I have to learn how to ground a lot harder and deeper, I should say, than when I'm here in the swamp. Because when you're in the swamp, it's natural grounding because it's swamp. Right. Where when you're in a different area of the country, there's nothing holding you down.
So yeah, I mean, I know the whole root thing. You get the roots to come up and grab you and hold on to you and ground you to the earth, and that's with the natural stuff. I would assume with the rocks out there, there's not much really to hold on to, huh?
No.
I'm gonna put rocks in my pocket.
Dude, your head, it will be like you just got done smoking 5 bongs, man.
High school.
Dude, yeah. Yeah, no, really, I'm serious. I mean, when I went out to Sedona before I learned that I thought I learned how to ground, and then I got to Sedona, and it's like, oh, why is it that I'm stoned? I haven't smoked anything. He says, you need to ground, dude.
Yeah, I guess if you don't do it right.
Yeah.
It could be a good night, though, depending on where you are. But, yeah, we just, it's a tough task, but I'm working at it, baby steps.
Yeah. And that's what I'm thinking. The day we actually went to Nuclear Lake, the last time we went, I was being pulled towards the swamp. And I told these guys, I said, man, I don't even want to look anywhere else for anything. I just want to go to the swamp. I'm being drawn to the swamp. And I was going to go without these guys because I was just being pulled. And they were like, no, you're not going alone. We're coming with you. And we went out there. And, you know, and first we get to the swamp and we can't really see anything because it's a swamp. And then something tells me to jump up on this huge rock, and I jump up on this huge rock, and then there's a pathway leading into the swamp, into the middle of the swamp, and then there's a footprint, and then there's a den, and then it looks like there's stuff inside the den, and it's just, I mean, it was just, I guess that's the reason why I was being pulled out there to find that den and to find what's in it. Brian actually bought a drone. We're going to fly it in the den next time we go.
I'm probably going to piss something really off bad, but, you know, why not?
Why not? Go for it.
If we can get the video, that's all that matters.
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be great, though. And I'm going to try to send you over some of the two shots that we have from actually that Nuclear Lake where we got the den. And you can, you blow them up a little bit, you'll be able to see these creatures that are in there, and you can definitely see teeth and you definitely also see the footprint. I actually circled the footprint the first time, and
well,
then
the
next one I'm gonna do it through Skype because I don't know how, if you can transfer it over to the chat room for anybody else that was there.
I can't.
That'd be great.
I can't. Okay. I'm on a different computer than my chat room, and okay. So I can't. But that picture that you sent me of the landmass that Amanda was talking about next to Australia.
I still haven't seen that picture.
Yeah. Well, Brian sent me the picture, and I am going to post that in Facebook along with, you know, when I got the podcast up and ready to go and all that kind of stuff for you guys. And
I wonder if he sent it to you. I wonder if you sent it to him directly as opposed to the group, so he saw it and I didn't.
No, you know what? I can actually repost it to the group right now.
I don't think I have you on Skype.
I got it on when you were on. We were on another chat, and you were one of the people in the room. So I sent it that way, but I'm going to try to send it again. See if we can get that for you.
I have you on Facebook.
Yeah, you could send it in this chat if you wanted to.
Yeah, I'll do it right now, and then this way you'll have it. I just sent the two photos.
I see the footprints.
Yeah, the footprint, and then the next one you got to blow up. You'll see eyes and a snarl, like you can see some teeth, which was pretty interesting. But
there's a lot of stuff happening in that picture, but you really have to look close.
Yeah,
to see
there we go. That picture
right
there.
That's the picture I was talking about from Days
I remember that globe. I remember looking at that, man. I do beyond, and it's like, I remember looking at that globe and the next day going to school and going, where's that thing next to Australia? And everybody looked at me like I was stupid. Seriously.
Well, that.
But then everybody always thought I was stupid anyway.
Going in and out of different, you know, timelines, you know, where we're in A and B's creeping in and then A comes back out and so on and so forth.
I always took some of what we're talking about with that and took it as, and I'm sure I have jumped realities or timelines or whatever. I'm sure I have in my life. But that, something like that, you know, where, like, for example, Kalamazoo, Michigan was up by Lake Superior, you know, right. When I was a kid, and now it's down by the border of Ohio and Michigan. It's what the fuck is up with that?
I just sent another one with a JFK. I found the JFK. I remember four people being in the car. JFK in the back with his wife. And then you have the driver, and the guy. I think he was the governor of Texas in the front.
Yeah, he was the governor, I believe.
That was it. And now when I'm seeing these pictures, it looks like someone elongated the limo. And
does it look edited, though? I haven't seen it yet. Does it look edited, or does it look official, or
this guy with the hat on? I don't. What the JFK thing? So people know I'm looking at. I don't.
There's John and Jack. There was Jackie and John and the driver.
No, there was just the driver and Jackie and John and John, and that's it. There wasn't this guy. This is like what the hell?
Who else got shot with Kennedy?
The guy I told you, the guy walking alongside the car.
Oh, you said a guy walking. I don't remember any guy walking.
Yeah, the
FBI. There was Secret Service agents.
Secret Service all over the car, man. They were walking next to the car, and one of the Secret Service agents got shot.
Running, jumping on the back as it sped up, but that's...
That video that I saw in the chat room, I watched the very first 10 seconds of that because I was busy. I wanted to make sure I paid attention to you guys. But I saw that. I've never seen that video before in my life, but I've seen all the others. And I go, where the hell has this video been?
Well, a great example is go to the Oliver Stone film and see what the car looks like. He really did investigate that. That's something that he needs to be aware of because he's big on the whole conspiracy right there. I remember seeing black and white or semi-color, whatever it was, but it was a four-seater. They didn't have a third row.
No, they didn't. It was a
no.
They had the front seat and the back seat. Yeah. They didn't have any more than that.
Yeah,
that's why when people, you know, we used encyclopedias growing up. You'd have to buy them, and my dad actually worked for one of the companies. We had them, and you'd have to look it up, and that's real print. You can't change that. It's almost like the Blu-ray mentality now, where, you know. At will, you can edit and insert whatever you want. There was a movie out called Murder by Death, Neil Simon. And that movie had a totally different ending. But when you get the DVD, it's not the same ending. So
yeah,
I know directors cut these things, and when they re-release and they remaster, they may have put different footage in, or they like that footage better. I mean, George Lucas did that with Star Wars. It was Luke, I'm your father. I'll bet everything on it. You know,
yeah,
that's what it was.
I agree. Yeah.
When I heard you guys talking about it, I'm like, no, Luke, I'm your father. I mean, it's quoted everywhere. Everybody quotes the same thing. So that could be a remix. You have to go back to like the VHS cassette box set and look for that scene, and you'll see it. But this stuff with Kennedy is just someone screwing around. I mean...
And yeah, it's problem. More misinformation and just nonsense. Absolutely. I that's what I think.
I mean, you know, they have this technology now, which is pretty cool and scary, where I don't have to be logged in as a YouTube user, but I can put, let's say you had a video of Donald Trump. I can mimic my facial expressions and have him say whatever I want him to say. Anybody. You can do it to anything or anyone.
Yeah, I know, and it's what's so scary about it.
And with the public at large, just, you know, all they do is look at their palms and their hands and their phones, and they get 5-10 seconds worth of soundbite, and they go with that. They don't even research anything anymore.
No,
you could really screw around with a lot of people. So,
well, when you look at the, I am dead serious about the Hillary lookalikes. When you look at the pictures, it seems like every other picture is a different picture of Hillary Clinton. It's like there's one of her being 50 years old, and one of her being as old as she would be today, and one of them where she looks like she's 30.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, mm-hmm. It's like, and they're all supposed to be in the present day.
Well, what's interesting is I'm going to use the 9/11 memorial as the subject. When she passed out in that, and clearly she was being held up.
Yeah, she was. Having petite mal seizures. Petite mal seizures. I used to work for the Epilepsy Foundation of Ohio. I used to have epilepsy. I know how to recognize epilepsy. And she was having petite mal seizures. And every time that she'd start shaking her head and stuff like that, she had petite mal seizures. And the funny thing about me coming out on the radio last week and saying she had petite mal seizures, after that, started using a different double. She wasn't having those seizure episodes anymore.
When she came out like an hour or two later, the person that came out was lost a couple of those double chins, was about 20 to 30 pounds lighter,
yeah.
Was wearing different earrings,
yeah.
And was carrying a purse. Hillary does not carry a purse.
No.
So she's apparently used these things in the past. The problem you have here is how gullible the audience is, and to believe that, oh, everything's fine.
and what about if she has pneumonia? Why is she breathing all over that little girl she did a picture with?
Yeah, exactly.
And there's no Secret Service with her at the time.
Yeah, I was just about to say, how did that little girl even get to her? That could have been a sniper. That could have been, you know. And if she was that sick that she almost passed out or possibly had a seizure or possibly died, and she went to her daughter's house, you don't think Chelsea would have, like, walked her to the door? Or someone would have walked her from the door to the van, not just to protect her, like their job, but in case she passes out again.
Absolutely. Well, better than that, her daughter has a baby. Why would you have your mom come up with pneumonia?
Well, how do you function with I've had pneumonia. I know how it kicked my ass.
Dude,
it kicks your ass. You can't get out of bed. You can't do anything. You can't make it to the bathroom to wipe your own ass because that's how bad off you are. How do you get on stage and talk if you have pneumonia? The answer is simple. That story is false.
There's a lot going on with this woman that not too many people know about or want known. The other day, she was pulled off of her PR tour because, I'm like, her eye was just bugged out. I don't know if you ever saw it.
Yeah, I saw a picture of that one eye. It was all.
I thought she's like going to do like the wife of Peter Falk, you know, like do a Columbo episode. Because
wait, just one more thing.
It was just really screwy. I mean, I have a picture of it, and it's just. Oh my God! I just can't believe that she actually. I'm sending it to you guys right now. This is just like you want to give this person the nuclear codes. I don't. She's forgetful. She faints. She passes out. She can't handle anything.
That picture's freaking scary.
I want to know who's going to do the debate because when she's under pressure, this is why she's not doing those interviews and doing anything. When she's under pressure, what's going to happen at that debate? Because if it's the real Hillary, and she's having all these problems, she's gonna probably drop dead right there.
Debate, if all of a sudden she's really, really well spoken, that's gonna be the tell. Watch like how she says what she says. Because I mean,
exactly.
Obviously she's gonna have the mannerisms down pat and stuff if she's an impersonator. But you know, just the way she presents what she's being told to say and stuff, and thinking on her feet. I just wonder if it's going to be a really, really obvious.
I want to know how they're throwing her voice. Like, how do they throw the double's voice? Like, how many people are there that can throw their voice and sound exactly like somebody else? I tell you what, if you take all those different people that are throwing their voices and you put them all together and do a voice print, every one of them is going to be different.
Oh yeah.
You know what? I still confuse Tina Fey with Chickie from Alaska. Yes, I swear to God, I still confuse them. You know, it's supposed very to be subtle, a sketch, but if you try hard, I mean, if you look like them anyway, just by default, just by genetics, and you're being paid big bucks to impersonate them, I mean, I don't know.
This whole debate's going to cause a lot of problems, not only for the candidates, specifically Hillary, but for the moderators, because no one's going to be using earpieces. It's going to be, you know, try to be fluid, and it's going to be very awkward. And I think if the people are there that should be there, like really Hillary and really the moderator, I honestly believe that Trump is going to be so on that night, it's going to destroy her. She should just back out now because.
Okay, but now really if we're all talking about this, like this could be a thing, why hasn't Trump even hinted? You know, just as an off-color joke or something, just to stir the pot. Or
well,
do you think something's going to happen
about
in the
debate? He kind of did recently with like, "Hope you have a nice nap, Hillary," or you know, "Get your rest." See you at the debate, and I think that's what he said. And
well, I think that's
I don't think he's
going to
come out like. Well, I don't think he's going to come out like the Trump. Oh, crooked Hillary, crooked, crooked. I think he's just going to keep going at her and at her and at her because he's that type of. You know, person, he won't stop. And if this is the real Hillary, unless she's on diazepam or whatever they're going to give her,
Prozac.
She's going to melt. I mean, it's going to be a really that first debate will be the last debate, and she's going to be destroyed. There's no way. I mean,
I'm actually excited about a political debate. Seriously, I think I'm going to try to watch the whole thing.
The other question. About this whole thing, this comes from Alex Jones, not that he's listening.
That's the guy I was talking about.
He's not listening, but Alex Jones. There is this date, the 26th, and I'm thinking the 26th. This is just my thoughts: is that Trump becomes nominated for president after the election in the 26th, after everything's all said and done. That's when he gets shot.
Well, that's there's a video from Jones of this guy was on the New Jersey Turnpike, so we get a little color for them. And he's listening to the AM, the 1650 or 30, which gives you the traffic update or warnings.
That's what I'm talking about.
And it was a repeated hack. Trump will go 26. Trump will go 26 or something to that effect.
That's what I was talking about.
I was wondering
right
if the
there.
2 and the 6 were actually not metaphors, but symbols for something. Or maybe we're hearing 26, but maybe it's 86. And it's just not as clear because it is repeating really quickly, and we all know what 86 means. So,
yeah,
you know, who knows what'll happen? I just think what the powers that be don't realize is if they go to that point, then there really is going to be a problem because I think people have had enough, and a lot of people, men, women, race, creed, colors, are waking up to the fact that these people are full of crap. And they're jumping on the other train and away from the Hillary thing. Wow. And
the government can't let that happen.
What I'm thinking is that between the cops killing people that are innocent, that are not threats, and you know, the guy in a wheelchair, the pastor, you know, and between that and these fake fucking pressure cooker bombing things that are going on. The people have had enough. People aren't stupid. Everybody knows Hillary didn't have fucking pneumonia. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows what the hell you go through with pneumonia, or they've had a family member go through it and they've watched it.
And then she comes dancing out of the house 2 hours later.
When do you take the keys away from Grandpa for driving the car? Because
there you go.
Seriously, with Hillary, think about it. I mean, like, honestly, unless you're really that dumb and stupid, look at this person, her health, what she's been doing. How can you vote for this person to be the leader of this country? She's a threat to everything.
Well, so there's so many questions with that. Like, if she, like I said earlier, I don't know if you guys heard it or not. If she dies before she takes office, that maybe Sanders would get in, but
it wouldn't be Sanders.
If she wins the if her campaign that team wins the election, then her VP is actually becomes president of the United States.
But wouldn't that be already sworn in if she died in office? What happens if before she is sworn in she dies? Yeah, it doesn't matter.
They won.
Well, yeah, they won. It. Yeah.
There'll be a lot of legal battles, but
person with the highest it'll be, count,
what is his name, Kane or whatever his name is?
No, it would be her. It would be her vice president.
Vice president would take
with her, yeah.
Okay, well, no. I don't even know the VP's name. So, as far as I'm concerned, a total stranger is going to be running your country. or scarier still, Hillary is dead, and you are literally electing someone you don't know as president. What if it is a devil? I mean, it won't matter because she's just going to say what she's told to say and do what she's told to do anyway. It's not really going to make a difference, but just think about that. A total stranger, if a doppelganger is your new president, can you imagine?
Doppelganger. That, there you go.
Amanda, yeah, is definitely conspiracy theory.
Who could write that? I wouldn't believe that in a script. I can write something better than
that. Hey.
And that whole bombing the other weekend, I listened to Hoagland last night, and I could write a better script than that. How that all felt for her. I mean, all right.
Al and Brian, I got a question. Is Amanda being an excellent co-host? She just took over. She's co-hosting.
She's doing a great job. So I'm sorry about the cursing right there, but
yeah.
Amanda has it going on. She knows what she's doing.
I don't. That's awesome. The thing. I'm just, if I see a question in chat, sure I'll ask it. But since I don't, I'm just going to ask what I want to know. And I don't know anything, so this is fascinating for me. If I'm going to be on, I'm going to make the best of it. I'm going to get all the info I can.
You better be careful, girl, because I'll hire you in as a co-host there.
It works well. It's very fluid, and it's always good to have a second or a third person there to kind of bounce stuff off of. Very, very few people can run out there and, you know, run the show. It's always good to have someone to relax or go back on to, so you can get other things, you know, push things forward, you know, make sure I got those EVPs and you know, you get in there still, but it helps out a lot.
I say hire.
Yeah, hire.
Hire.
And we still have listeners. I'm surprised.
You want to pay Canadian, though? No.
Oh, hey now.
Well, I don't know if it's dangerous right now. But a couple of weeks ago, just before the Labor Day weekend, that Saturday, I was actually down on the Jersey Shore, Jenkinson's boardwalk, and it was at night. We took the two young ones with us, and we got evacuated from a certain portion of it.
Yeah, and I remember you posting that.
40 cops came up, and then we started talking to people, and there was dogs there, and they were responding, and they said there was a suspicious package. So we moved down the boardwalk. Waited a couple minutes, I videotaped a little bit, and then we decided to go into another arcade or whatever, and within 5 minutes, they said, no, it's closed, so the boardwalk is closed. I have a lot of friends in three-letter agencies and family members, and they do, you know, what they do, and I've read the Al-Qaeda manual, which is basically the CIA manual, and there's a certain methodology of how these people think and how they operate.
Okay.
And once I saw this report about Seaside Heights, the first thing that went into my mind was the Jenkinsons on the boardwalk was used as basically it's a response time. You want to check out the response time and what they're going to do, because it's the same playbook all these police stations use. It's not like New York City. And that's why I think that this guy did or whatever bomb was placed down there was successful, because they knew exactly how they would hit, what they were checking. There's no dogs there. They did what they did. I do think it's a little bit more amateur about the explosions. But you got to understand that if you brought it up to the 42nd Street area, which I've worked in for years, you're going to get caught immediately. So what you want to do is you want to create that psychology that this is taking place within an area. And they did. I mean, you know, people are still a little bit gun-shy right now going into the city. There was a boom recently today. Sonic boom, but people were nervous. So the job of terrorism does work. Now, whether these people are working for or part of the ISIS crew, don't know. Are they part of another powers that be crew? Don't know. But, you know, this day and age, it could be a multitude of different things. I mean, I think I think we were talking on another show about, Lucky found the advertisement in Craigslist up in Canada for crisis actors. And something that's going to happen November 8th. They wanted, you know, crisis actors out of the country. $1,000 a day.
Well, the November 8th, the day after the election? I could see that happening.
So then the ad mysteriously went down, and the company that was hiring them actually was a U.S. government company. And, you know, call it conspiracy theory, but if it looks like a duck or walks like a duck and talks like a duck,
it's a duck.
You know, so... You know, there's a lot of fact behind conspiracy theory. It's, you know, until you pull it out. It's been done all over the place. False flags are everywhere.
I don't know if I like that term, though. Conspiracy theory makes it sound like it's just a handful of crazy people. But, I mean, when you have serious, legitimate questions that no one is answering, either they don't have answers or the answers just don't logically make sense... How is that a conspiracy theory? How is that lunacy? I mean...
Well, because what happens now is the truth is so... If you could... The truth is so unfathomable that people just think it's nuts. They rather believe the story, the narrative that someone's putting out there, than the actual truth. So then they make you look like a lunatic or you're an idiot or whatever. You know... I see it all the time. Oh, you're just a conspiracy theorist or whatever. No, I'm a BSR, you know, like analyzer. I look at the BS and you get a gut reaction like, this is crap. This is a lie. This is, you know, this is the, we were going to go bankrupt. Our bonds were going to go down. We didn't have the money. And this was a couple of years back. And to break that news, to get people away from looking at that, that night we caught Osama bin Laden. Right?
Yeah.
So they say.
And what's scary is this is like a 2011 or something like that had happened. But you can hear the president of Pakistan, she said, I don't know why the Americans here, they got Osama or bin Laden, you know, in 03 or whatever the number was. And the day later she was assassinated. So they warned her not to talk to David for us, but this is out there. People don't want to believe it. Oh, we got him. Yay, we got him. There's no video. There's no body. No one saw him. Yeah, okay.
Just take your word for it. Absolutely. Yeah, I'm not buying it. I'm not buying it at all.
Speaking of Alex Jones, didn't he have someone who was, I don't know, they were legally trying to fight to reopen the 9/11 investigation or something, and she was on his show and said I'll come back after the case is won, and he was joking around saying, please, for the record, tell my audience that you are not in any way, shape, or form contemplating suicide. And she was laughing, saying, no, there's absolutely no way I'm gonna kill myself, you know, I feel really strong, I have all this evidence. And a week after the court case, apparently, her mother walked into the garage and found her hanging by, like, nylon stockings or something.
Yeah, and I mean, you know what?
I don't know.
Again, on the on the same list, the only guy that is really pro-Constitution or actually will sit there and judge properly, Justice Scalia is dead. Oh, he had a heart attack with a pillow over his face. Yep, okay, got it. Yep. Nothing to see here, people. Move on. You put it out there, but you know people don't want to hear it. It's only logical. He was the deciding vote for all these things. They replace him, it becomes more of a liberal, whatever you want it, party, and they reverse everything. And they will reverse everything. Give them an inch, they will take 10,000 miles. So, but people don't want to hear it. They think you're nuts.
Easy,
so.
Big guy. Easy, bro.
Yeah. All right, guys.
Sorry. Well,
this is awesome, man. The show went over. It was a good show. Everything worked out smoothly. I didn't know what the hell we were going to do this morning when me and Amanda were talking. It was like, you know, and it's like, well, things will come together the way that they're supposed to, and that's just the way that it works. So, anyways, guys, you have a good night, and thank you so much for being here.
Nice chatting with you guys.
I will have
chatting with you, Amanda.
Other than the news, this is probably going to be the last time you hear me on the radio because Arizona wants to stay employed. So.
Nah, see, I'm the boss. I'm the owner. I'm the CEO. I do what the hell I want to do.
There you go.
I own all of nothing.
And thank you for inviting us on tonight. It's been fun.
Oh, man. Thanks for
Bye
being
Bye, everyone
here
in chat. Shippers. Have a nice evening.
Y'all have a good one, man. And cool. I will just tell everybody bye-bye. Good
night, folks.
Good night, folks.
Okay, I'll see you. Bye. What's going on here? Did it freeze? There we go. All righty, guys. Remember, we are the only radio station with a frog in a blender. Thanks for sticking around. The podcast will be up tomorrow. You can listen to it and you can share it and you can find us all over the place. If it wasn't for you guys, I wouldn't have a need for being here. Y'all take care, be well, be safe, and until next time, I will see you. Bye. Settle down.